following is a special presentation of ESPN on ABC.
The San Francisco Bay Area on a gorgeous evening for college football. And a laid-back California crowd begins the stroll up the hill to Strawberry Canyon. Oregon's in town. It's the Bears and the Ducks. And for Berkeley, it's a very big deal.
They have their own way of doing things, their own style, their own path. It's through the air most of the time, and at all times, it's fast. Football in the West, free-spirited, full of color, excitement, and fun. Like a view of the Pacific coastline, it'll take your breath away. So take a deep gulp of rich October oxygen. Tonight, the California Golden Bears and the Oregon Ducks air it out in prime time, Pac-10 style, on Saturday Night Football.
You are looking live at California's Memorial Stadium. It's the kind of evening sprinters love to strut their stuff. Let the scoreboard lights start to dance, folks, Pac-10 style, as we welcome you to Saturday Night Football, presented by Southwest Airlines. Here at California Memorial Stadium, it's the number 11 Oregon Ducks and the number 16 California Golden Bears. A very good evening and a welcome to everybody. I'm Brett Musburger, along with the coach, Bob Davey. Now, Kirk Herbstreit is with the gang down in Gainesville. We'll be hearing from them shortly. But you know, Bob, we're going to be talking about a 60-point evening here tonight.
Brent, I think you might be right. You know, when people around the country think about Pac-10 football, they think about explosive offenses and a lot of points. I think tonight's game is going to confirm those thoughts. Both these offenses have a different style, but they have one thing in common. They both score a lot of points. Oregon averages 40 points a game. They run the true spread offense. They use the quarterback as a runner. Cal, on the other hand, 38 points a game. More of a pro-style offense. Their quarterback is a true drop-back-style quarterback.
We watched Washington scare USC. Now, are the Trojans vulnerable out West?
Well, maybe by USC's standards, they are vulnerable. But everyone knows, to win the Pac-10, you're going to have to beat the Trojans. Both these teams get a chance to go do it later in November. I think the winner of this game tonight, Brent, has a legitimate shot to do it because they're going to leave here with a lot of confidence and a lot of momentum.
Bob, you would agree with me. Two of the best running backs in the country. Jonathan Stewart of the Ducks tonight. He's matched against number 10, Marshawn Lynch of the Golden Bears. Which one of these great backs tonight will be invincible?
ESPN on ABC, and coming up next, a big Pac-10 battle. Very important. Both these teams have USC on the schedule later. It is coming up next on Saturday Night Football. John Saunders, Craig James, and Doug Flutie, the two geniuses, we'll get to talk in just a moment. But first, baseball and the New York Yankees. Oh, the money they spent. Oh, the power they had. Oh, they're gone. Craig Monroe, two-run shot here. 3-0 Detroit has the lead. You're going to see Posada strike out, but consider this as you watched it. All the money that George Steinbrenner spent His team went 20 consecutive innings without scoring a run. So the Tigers will win, and they'll go on to face the Oakland A's in the American League Championship Series. Arkansas against Auburn. Auburn undefeated coming into this game and ranked number two. A little trickery here. They snap it right to Reggie Fish. He goes 29 yards.
You know what? I don't think many people thought that Arkansas would even score very many points against Auburn, let alone go out and upset them.
LSU against Florida. Florida, Tim Tebow.
Little jump pass, double clutch, pump fake. He's an athlete. This is fun football right here.
He almost traveled with his feet to come down, right? jump shot.
Came back down on that one. We, of course, will see you with plenty more at halftime, showing you all the scores and highlights. Number one, Ohio State remains unbeaten as well. But right now, we want to take you out to Chris Fowler. Chris.
Thanks, John. There's joy in the Gator Nation as Florida cashes in on blunders by the Bayou Bengals to move to 6-0. Lee Corso and Kirk Herbstreit joining us here tonight, but set to watch the game from Berkeley. Boy, perhaps an unsurpassed collection of skill and speed in the field with the Ducks and the Bears.
You know, Cal's averages 43 points a game in the last four games. Oregon averages 40. I think Cal is the best all-around team to pack in, so I'm picking Cal 43, Oregon 40.
Well, I think there's no question that Cal's going to put points up on the board. Nate Longshore really improving. Marshawn Lynch, DeShay Jackson, they have players all over the place. But I think Oregon can win this game. In order to do it, it's about Dennis Dixon and, of course, Jonathan Stewart. That combination, I think, outscores Cal.
Well, Florida's talking about being number two in the country here. If the Ducks can win at Cal, perhaps Oregon can make a case for the top five. Kirk will join Brett Musburger and Bob Davey at the end of the third quarter from here in Gainesville. But now to Berkeley. Take it away, Brent.
Thank you very much, Chris, and welcome everybody to Berkeley, California. Coach Jeff Tedford leads the Bears onto the field, and for the first time, they're wearing these yellow jerseys. You can decide at home if you like them. They're taking a page out of the Ducks book. Nate Longshore, the quarterback, and the head coach, Jeff Tedford, who for 4 years was an outstanding offensive coordinator under Mike Bellotti at Oregon. This ESPN production is available on ABC HD, presented by Dish Network. Well, Bellotti and Tedford have squared off three times in the past. Bellotti has a 2-1 edge on his former assistant. Three games decided by a total of 12 points. And against Cal overall, Bellotti 7-1, good record. Let's check in with Lisa Salters. Lisa?
Well, Brent, I caught up with Cal quarterback Nate Longshore during warm-ups, and I said to him, look, everyone says this is going to be a high-scoring affair. What kind of game are you expecting? And he said one word, defense. And I kind of looked at him funny, and I said, are you sure with all of this offense on the field tonight? And he said, I'm telling you, one of these teams, somebody's going to come up big on the defense. And he said, you know what? When it happens, you're going to think to yourself, Nate was right. Brent?
We will wait and hold judgment on that, Lisa. Mike Bellotti. Gary Crotton, of course, his offensive coordinator now, the one-time head coach at BYU, and he brought the wide-open spread. Mike won the toss, and he elected to receive. So he wants to go on the attack against his one-time assistant, Jeff Tedford, right off the bat. So we will see Dennis Dixon, the Ducks quarterback. And another thing Bellotti doesn't have to worry about early on here, Bob, is kicking the ball off. That's been one of the Ducks' weaknesses, but they're going to receive right away.
And you wonder if that did affect his decision to take the football, Brent. Last week against Arizona State, Oregon had a kickoff run back on them for a touchdown by the Sun Devils. Also a big punt return.
Terrific crowd on hand. It's just about 15 minutes after 5 o'clock here on the West Coast. Andrew Larson, a punter, is putting the ball down on the tee for the Golden Bears, and the Ducks are back deep. Jonathan Stewart and Jeremiah Johnson. So they never list them on the depth chart, but then out will pop their two best running backs.
And Jonathan Stewart led the country in kickoff returns last year as a freshman.
In Berkeley. Coming out from the one is Johnson. Short at the 20-yard line, down at about the 18-yard line. So Dixon will come out.
And there is a big three as far as impact players are concerned. Dixon, the quarterback, with Jonathan Stewart and Jason Williams. They're good too, Coach.
And Brent, you're going to see the true spread offense. Dennis Dixon, the fastest quarterback in the history of Oregon football. Look for him to run the football tonight out of this spread set.
There is the formation you'll be looking at with Dixon up, squaring it with Enoka Lucas, his outstanding center, switches the running back over to his right side. Offensive line holds, and it's intercepted. The first play of the game picked off by Brandon Hampton, the junior from Los Angeles. And the Bears have a first and goal to begin the evening.
And that is not what Mike Bellotti had in mind when he decided to take the football. Brandon Hampton, the 5'10", 180-pound junior. Dennis Dixon gets a little bit of pressure and flat just throws it to Brandon Hampton.
The Bears are on the Ducks' 7-yard line to begin the game. There's Hampton who picked it off. Marshawn Lynch, the ace running back, gets the first call, bounces. Gained about a yard, just short of the 5-yard line. We talked about the big three at Oregon, and California matches them. Well, you take a look at their three of a kind, well, stars.
Let's give Nate Longshore credit. He said defense was going to decide this game, Brent, and they got the big turnover, but he's been on fire since the Tennessee game, which was the first game of the year. He's completing 70% of his passes since that time, and Marshawn Lynch and DeSean Jackson, maybe the two most dynamic players in the entire Pac-10.
Second down and goal for Longshore and the Bears. Gonna throw for it. Incomplete. And a flag comes late. Thrown by the line, the field judge, down at the goal line. Interference, first and goal, half the distance. Jack Wood, the referee, Pac-10 crew. The umpire will spot that ball.
And Brent, the interference is going to be on number 6, Walter Thurman.
Pass interference, defense. By rule, the ball will be placed at the 2-yard line. First down.
I think you're going to see it right here. Just bump and run coverage. Grab them a little bit right there with that left hand.
From the 2-yard line, the Bears come up. Back offset to the right. They send power in that direction. And Lynch is stoned in the hole. Nothing doing. It'll be second down and goal. The first player to hit him was J.D. Nelson. Familiar name. He's the son of Darren, who once played at Stanford, moved on to the NFL.
And they talk about J.D. Nelson, the heart and soul of this defense, Brent, and that was a big lick. Marshawn Lynch at about 230 pounds, the tailback.
Checking the wristband. Cal scores its entire game plan on that. They send a number in to Nate. He has it now for second and goal. Bootleg. Can he get there? He throws for it high. Caught back out of the end zone. Back judge right there. Incomplete. I thought he could run for it.
And you see the difference in these two quarterbacks, Brent. You're right. Nate Longshore looked like he had a chance to run to it for it. And the fullback, Byron Storer, actually knocked out of bounds, it looks like, by his own guy right there. Yeah, excellent call. That foot was on the line, don't you think?
Absolutely.
third down and goal for the Bears. If you just joined us, they intercepted the first play of the game, giving them a first and goal, then a pass interference. Gave them a first from the two. Now it is third and goal as Oregon making a goal line stand. Wide open. Touchdown, California. Goes to the tight end, Craig Stevens. A very big part of the Cal game plan here tonight. He was very prominent in their practices early in the week, and he scores the first touchdown of the evening following the interception. Extra point is perfect. Tom Schneider, who is now 26 of 26 after nailing that one. A breakdown in the coverage. The Bears strike first. Oregon's turn coming up.
John Saunders in New York for your prime time pulse over on ESPN. Tennessee leading Georgia 7-3. ESPN2, another SEC game. South Carolina over Kentucky 10-0. Brent, back to you.
And John, of course, here, the California Golden Bears scoring after the turnover. And the Ducks will go on the attack for the second time here tonight, early on in the game. Less than 3 minutes in. Seven on the board already. Stevens, the tight end, with the touchdown. And Hampton made the interception. He'll come downfield now on the kickoff team. Andrew Larson handling the kickoffs. Stewart and Johnson, the two running backs, are back deep, trying to break one. Johnson from, this is Stewart. Let me check that. They switched spots this time. And Stewart out of bounds at the 25.
Brent, you said it. It all started with Brandon Hampton on the interception, the first offensive play of the game. That sets up tremendous field position. I want you to watch this play. The tight end, Craig Stevens, right here, 82, is going to delay and hide Oregon in man-to-man coverage, turns him loose. That's a well-designed offensive play against man-to-man coverage.
Jason Williams, the Ducks' rangy, talented receiver, is off to the right of the formation. Four wide, option look. Dixon keeps it and steps his way to the 34-yard line as we take a look at the City Oregon offense. Now, this offensive line, their average size, 6'5", 317, one of the best out west, only one sack they've surrendered all season. Lucas could make the all-Pac-10 team as the center this year. He's the ringleader. Second down and two for the Ducks. Pounding Stewart right straight ahead toward that yellow line in the first down. And Tafisi makes the stop as we see the defense now. They've got a good one at every level. Mebane, Desmond Bishop, the linebacker, their number one tackler, and Damian Hughes, number 13. He's going to spend a lot of time tonight trying to defend number four, Jason Williams. And we have an injured Oregon player down on the field, and I believe that could be the center, Lucas. Yes, that's exactly who it is. And that could be a major blow to the Ducks here early on. It looked like the left leg.
Brent, not only is he a great player, but every offensive snap of Oregon is out of the shotgun. And that timing is so critical, particularly when you're an option-style team like Oregon. So this is a critical injury here early in the football game. Number 51, Jeff Kendall, you see loosening up on the sideline. You mentioned this Oregon offensive line. Three of these players, including Anoka Lucas, from Hawaii. Three of these offensive linemen on Oregon's team. You see his leg twisted back over top of him.
It's not the way that left leg was designed to bend, was it? Concerned look over there on Coach Bellotti.
things not starting well. An interception on the first play of the game. Then you come back out in your second series. Your center is going to be out for at least a few plays. You would think he's going to have to go over for one by rule.
And Brent, the impact of Anoka Lucas. I went to the Pac-10 media day prior to the season in late July. Mike Bellotti brought Anoka Lucas with him to represent the Oregon football team, so you know he's a leader.
Near the end of the game, we'll select a Chevrolet player of the game from each team. To honor their determination, Chevrolet will make a $1,000 contribution to each university's general scholarship fund. First and 10 for the Ducks. Another first down at midfield, and it goes to Brian Paysinger, the junior from Long Beach, California.
Brian Paysinger, the fastest of the Oregon receivers, and they have some speed, but the coaches tell me he is the fastest guy on this offense.
Takes a break on this play. Three wide. Dante Rosario makes it strong to the left on the formation. Deflected. And down there. So Dante was the intended receiver.
It's interesting, Brent. This Oregon offense comes in the number one ranked rushing offense in the Pac-10. They've not led the Pac-10 since 1955 in rush offense. So you see the ability of this spread offense to run the football.
Jonathan Stewart, the running back, goes over to Dixon's right. And that's Williams, number four. The big three all lined up back there. And a whistle flag comes down.
Prior to the snap, full start. Offense number 61. 5-yard penalty remains, second down.
That was Churgy, the left guard. So certainly not the kind to start Bellotti, but good news as Lucas, number 55, returns and Kendall comes out. So a welcome sight for the Ducks.
And Oregon, a big screen team, Brent. They probably threw 12 screens last week against Arizona State, particularly the wide receivers.
Have the field spread. Got time. Left side wide open. And with his first catch, Jordan Kent, the son of the Ducks basketball coach. Ernie's in attendance tonight watching his son.
And how about Jordan Kent in high school won the 100, the 200, the 400, and the long jump state championships in Oregon. And he plays basketball. That's a pretty good combination, isn't it?
There's Coach.
Trying to get those girls to sit down right there.
So he can see us.
Yeah.
First down now, Dixon. Just starting to warm up. Paysinger, Kent, Finley. Now that Finley with his first catch, all have gotten into the rotation. Eight Duck receivers and running backs have five or more catches coming into this game. And you can see spreading the ball around. And the ace, Jason Williams, is looking for his first reception of the night. And chasing him is Damian Hughes. Pump fake, Dixon's going to take off for the first down. And he's tripped up by Desmond Bishop as we check in with Lisa.
Well, Brent, here's something else interesting about Jordan Kent. Believe it or not, he never played football, organized football, on any level before last season. And that's absolutely amazing. His coach says he had no idea how to even use the equipment, how to put on the chin strap, how to put on the pads. And now he's saying that because he's getting a lot of attention from NFL scouts, that if he continues to do well, he may not play basketball or run track at Oregon this season. Right?
And Stewart is hit by Mebane on that play. One thing is becoming very evident as far as the California coaching staff is concerned. Bob Gregory, the defensive coordinator of the Bears, is shadowing Williams with Damian Hughes. Damian is their fine corner, number 13, with five interceptions. He's over now on the right side defensively, matched against number four. Dixon doesn't even look in that direction. Comes back to Kent to the 11-yard line. Bishop again.
Boy, you see the passing ability of Dennis Dixon, the perfect quarterback for the spread offense. And you know it's a homecoming for Dennis Dixon as well. Today's Cal's homecoming game with this Oregon quarterback from right down the road in San Leandro, Brent, only 10 minutes from this Berkeley campus.
Now Hughes comes over to the left side of the defense to take Williams. They're trying to shut him down, and the Ducks are picking him apart with their other receivers. They bunch, throw the screen over there to the running back. And Jonathan Stewart, who was behind the receivers, they are just looking away. And penalty flags come flying.
Dead ball, personal foul, defense number 10. Penalty will be enforced half the distance from the end of the play. Automatic first down.
That's Bishop. Coach Foster has his ace linebacker over on the sideline to settle him down. And the Ducks could be in business. A first and goal from the three. 8:15 remaining in the second quarter, and we could have our second touchdown of the night. Dixon on a play fake and a dash for it. Pump fake. Bears are there. Won't score. Bernard Hicks, the sophomore from Fresno, is up defensively.
And how tough is it to defend a quarterback, Brent, that is the fastest quarterback in Oregon football history, and also the kind of arm he's evidenced on this drive? And you notice Oregon, a no-huddle offense, huddles down here in the critical area of the red zone to make sure they're all on the same page from a communication standpoint.
Hughes goes out to the right side of the defense with Williams. Looks at him bump and run inside the 5-yard line. The running back is stopped as Bishop had come back into the lineup after being on the sideline for a play. Somewhere he's one of them as the Bears stop Bilotti's offense.
You see the focus for Bob Gregory and the Cal defense. Stop the run. That was their biggest concern coming into this game with this Oregon offense, number one in the Pac-10. But they've done an excellent job against the run so far.
Jeremiah Johnson checks in. He's into the backfield. They've got both the backs in there now. We asked Coach about it. He said we rarely do it, but here they are, third down and goal, Johnson and Stewart. Dixon to throw. Incomplete. Decision for Bilotti. He doesn't hesitate. Field goal unit trots onto the field. Get on the board here.
Remind Brent, this Oregon football team faked the field goal against Fresno to win the football game. When you play a Mike Bilotti team, always expect the unexpected in the kicking game.
Now, Paul Martinez is an outstanding kicker, Bobby. 7 of 9. He's hit all 20 of his extra point attempts. California tried to recruit him, and he opted to go up to Eugene and Oregon. With Brady Leaf the holder, the 22-yard field goal puts the Ducks on the board. It's 7-3. 10 points early in the first quarter.
Saturday Night Football on ABC, presented by Southwest Airlines. The low fare from here to there. It's on Southwest Airlines at southwest.com. Allstate, are you in good hands? Chevrolet, America's brand. Chevy, an American revolution. And Dr. Pepper, with 23 flavors in every Dr. Pepper, there's more to it.
Well, for years, you didn't think of California Golden Bears as a football school. Then Jeff Tedford moved down here from Eugene. They've always had an abundance of world-class athletes in this part of Northern California. He was able to turn the corner, recruit some of the best in this area, a promise of upgraded facilities, which are going to begin right at the end of this season, and the show is on the road. Now, Oregon's problem with the kickoff snap. Evanston will see what he can do here. Fielded at the two by Marcus O'Keefe, one of the tailbacks. Looking for a corner. And he is out to the 26-yard line, and we check in with John Saunders. John.
And in the Sports Center 30-30 update, first, the number two team in the nation loses. Auburn down to Arkansas. Darren McFadden had a great game, 63 yards on this touchdown rush. He had 145 on the day. In baseball, the Tigers, after losing game one, sweep out the Yankees. They'll go on to face the Oakland A's in the ALCS. Back to you, Brent.
I would not want to be around the boss, George Steinbrenner, tonight after his $200 million payroll spit the bit against the Tigers. Longshore, flanker screen. Marshawn Lynch, the running back, was over there as the receiver. He's an outstanding receiver. And when you think about the Cal offense and the receivers, not only do they have him as a running back, folks, they've got world-class speed. Lavelle Hawkins, Robert Jordan, and DeSean Jackson. He has run a 4.29. USC wanted to keep him right there in Southern California. He's one who got away from Pete Carroll. Craig Stevens, of course, the tight end, has the touchdown catch tonight for the Bears, who now have a first and 10 at the 45. Now his running ability between the tackles. Stopped at the 47-yard line by this Oregon defense that has lost Cole Linehan, a defensive tackle, broke a foot last week. Cornerback Jackie Bates broke a foot against Fresno. And Brent Haberle, a linebacker, broke an arm. So Blair Phillips, his hands are full. And J.D. Nelson, who is Darren Nelson's son, as we mentioned earlier in a broadcast, they have got to provide the leadership here tonight as the Bears are moving right back down the field. They have one touchdown, and of course they had just superb field position after the interception. Second down, and there's Robert Jordan's first reception of the night.
Brent, you talk about skill players. You went through that Cal lineup. These three wide receivers for Cal give Longshore excellent targets. This guy right here, Robert Jordan, kind of the third of the three. He's also a 4.40 as you look at DeSean Jackson right there. Maybe the most dynamic player in the Pac-10 now that Reggie Bush has gone to the NFL.
And that is saying a lot. Third and six, and Lavelle Hawkins. Dropped. Had the first down that time. And Sam DeSaw unable to hang on. The Bears are forced to punt. Andrew Larson averaging 43.8 yards a punt, 8 of his 19 inside the 20.
Yep. No question, DeSaw had a chance right there, Brent, for the first down. Just didn't make the play.
The three protectors that several schools are now showing up with. Jeremiah Johnson lets it go on into the end zone. It'll come out on the 20-yard line. And we've got a penalty flag thrown back around midfield. They were fourth and longer than five, weren't they, in this situation? Did we get an automatic here?
Holding, receiving team number 99. The foul occurred beyond the line of scrimmage and will be enforced as a post-scrimmage kick foul, half the distance from the 20-yard line, first down.
Jeremy Gibbs, number 99, on the return, called for holding, but Oregon gets the football.
And they'll start with it back on the 10-yard line when you come back to Berkeley on a gorgeous Saturday evening.
watching ESPN on ABC.
A landmark. Tight Wad Hill. The free seats. Looking down on our sellout crowd at Memorial Stadium. 7-3, their Bears lead the Oregon Ducks. The Ducks have the football coming out from the 10-yard line. Stewart looking for a corner. Out of bounds, just short of the first down. Picking up 9+. Hicks able to ram him out of bounds. But this will be second and short coming up for the Ducks.
I tell you what, you see what Jonathan Stewart's all about. 235 pounds. Runs a 4.34 40, benches 405 pounds. Chance, I think, to be the best back in the history of Oregon football. This guy is a big-time player.
Damian Hughes goes over to the right side of the defense. Tightens up on Jason Williams. So there are the Division 1A running backs. A pretty good group there, Coach.
How about three starts, over 140 yards in all three starts. Didn't play against Stanford because of an ankle. Pretty good cast of characters right there, those other three guys, too.
This is second down and 9. Obviously, he got a first down on the on that earlier run. I thought he was just shy of it, so let me correct myself. And now it is second down and 9. And look at that, Dixon create another first down, diving for it. Here's the big difference between these two teams, Coach.
No question, Brent. I mean, this is the true spread offense quarterback. One thing I would say to Dennis Dixon, tuck that football away a little bit. Hold it a little more high and tight. But he is a dynamic player as we look at Mike Bellotti.
Using his big back, picks up one block, but nothing doing. Saquon Thompson, number 5. To make the stop.
How about us, Brent? Iowa City last Saturday night, Berkeley tonight. That's a world of difference now. Now, I'm just not talking about miles. I'm talking about the whole deal. This is a great setting here tonight, though. Sold out crowd.
Next week, Happy Valley. Penn State and Michigan as Saturday night football rolls along. Linesman coming up. A little equipment problem. Jeremiah Johnson in as the running back. You can see they're tending to the helmet. That's why the game was stopped. It's Jonathan's helmet. That's why he's off to the side right now. Second down and 14. Penalty flag. You can see movement.
Prior to the snap, false start. Offense number 77. 5-yard penalty remains, second down.
Right guard Massoon.
Tedford has encouraged this crowd all week to be a factor. He learned, Brent, the opening game at Tennessee, what a loud crowd, what kind of effect that can have on a football game. And I'm impressed with this Cal crowd here.
They're into it. On second and 19. Can't find an open receiver. And he is dumped on the 21-yard line. Desmond Bishop, the hard-hitting linebacker, took his feet out on that play. Number 10.
And that is a great open field tackle. We ISO right here on Desmond Bishop, the linebacker. Just throws his body at Dennis Dixon and gets him on the ground. Not exactly a form tackle, Brent, but a great effort. You see that football jarred out right there.
Artificial turf bounced right back to him. Got the perfect hop on it. The Ducks have already turned it over once in the red zone. Third down and 20. five receivers spread across. Penalty flag, holding is called.
Holding, offense number 75. That penalty will be declined. Fourth down.
The hold is going to be right at the top here. Jeff Swartz, 75, has Nia Tafoa locked up.
Now a chance to see DeSean Jackson and that breakaway speed. Let's see if Oregon even lets him get close to this punt. Aaron Knowles made the trip, and he has replaced Matt Dragich tonight as the punter. So Aaron Knowles, number 98, back to punt. The three protectors. DeSean is hit just as he catches it. No fair catch, and let us check in with New York.
Brett, in the primetime pulse over on ESPN, Georgia has just scored again. Three consecutive touchdowns right now as they lead Tennessee 23-7. Over on ESPN2, the game is going to have remaining the same score, South Carolina by 10 over Kentucky. Brent, back to you.
Now, John, surprised that the Bulldogs found an offense tonight. Everybody said that for them to win that, it was going to be low scoring. And note their 23 here. 7-3, Cal with the lead, down to 2 minutes left, and the Bears with the ball coming out for the 45. Nate Longshore, sideline, dropped. Jordan could not hang on. So after that quick first touchdown, Bob, things have slowed down just a little bit. Oregon held to a field goal.
Exactly. You know, Cal comes into this game four straight games over 40 points a game.
Cal has passed for only 4 yards in this game, and one of them a 2-yard touchdown to Stevens. So Longshore and the Bears' highly touted passing game hasn't got it going yet. And they still haven't. Tried to go back to his tight end who scored, and another incompletion. And Longshore is now 2 of 6.
And some pressure by Dexter Manley. I think people around the country will recognize that name. His father played in the NFL. You look at Dexter Manley, he had 3 sacks, Brent, in the second quarter against Arizona State last week.
His daddy was a sack master with the Washington Redskins. His son came out of junior college, signed on at Eugene. Third down and 10. For the Bears, back in the gun. Prior to the snap. Yeah, it looked like Gibson incurred this penalty. Now back him up again.
Prior to the snap, full start. Offense, number 53. 5-yard penalty, still third down.
Neither team really has it going offensively like we expected to see here so far.
A lot of mistakes right now in this football game offensively.
Third and 15. Longshore gets time, fires, first down. Lavelle Hawkins, first catch of the night, and the longest pass play of the evening so far for the Bears. And it came on a third and 15. Nice play by Nate Longshore.
And Lavelle Hawkins, you see two deep coverage. Look at the middle of that football field wide open as they split those two safeties and went right down the middle. Brent, look at the grass, or in this case, artificial surface, wide open, and a huge third down conversion right there.
The 24-yard gain puts the ball on the 36-yard line. Deep middle, wide open. Touchdown, DeSean Jackson. 60 yards in two plays. 36 yards for the score.
And that's what 4-2-9-40 looks like against man-to-man coverage. He just beat Jarius Byrd, the corner.
Tom Schneider, been perfect this year. Tacks on another one. Penalty flag.
Jarius Byrd playing way off coverage, gets his hips turned to the sidelines, and then DeSean Jackson just beats him back inside to the post. And a good job by Nate Longshore of just laying that football up nice and soft to the wide open receiver.
So Oregon picks up another penalty for running into the kicker, and I think the referee is going to go over here. Send somebody over to talk to the coach. They have not put the extra point up on the board. The kick was good.
I would think they would take this on the kickoff, the penalty.
Five-yard running into the kicker on the defense. That penalty is declined. The try is good.
Took a lot of time to decide that.
Wow. Pretty good acting job by the kicker right there. Offense is, Brent, not executing at a real high level, but you see how quickly they can score right there.
So the Bears' second touchdown of the night makes it 14-3. And now it's up with to the Ducks to see if they can't exchange fire here. Stewart. Gamble that failed. Ball was coming loose a little bit, and he is down at the 14-yard line. A reminder now, next Saturday, most of you are going to see Michigan. How high will they climb in the polls this week? On the road in Happy Valley for a primetime showdown with Joe Paugh and the Nittany Lions, who pulled it out in overtime today against Minnesota. Others will see Arizona State take on USC. Saturday night football on ABC. Presented by Southwest Airlines, 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. College football lives here. Big crowd on hand. And the Bears, who've won four in a row after being throttled in Knoxville by Tennessee, lead at 14-3 as they climb their way back up the polls and in the Pac-10 race. Oregon, meanwhile, undefeated and trying to rally. And the big fella finally gets into the attack. Jason Williams, first catch of the night. And you can see how talented he is.
And there's some big receivers in this country, but this guy's the biggest. He's 6'5", 245, 177 yards receiving against Oklahoma.
There you see number 13, who's been shadowing him all night. Just gave up the first play. Option look. Dixon keeps it all the way to the 30-yard line. And Greg Van Hoosen, backup linebacker, seeing a little action here. Number 55. A junior from Saratoga, California. He's going to come back out. And Bishop returns. Second and eight. Bear defenders urging the crowd into it again. Sack. At the 21-yard line, Zach Follett.
And Zach Follett, a linebacker, miscommunication right there when the offensive line, Jeff Swartz, the right offensive tackle, didn't come off. Big sack by Zach Follett, the linebacker.
That is only the second sack of the season surrendered by the Ducks. Any more time on camera, and we're going to make him enroll in AFTRA.
A whistle was inadvertently blown because the 25-second clock was inadvertently started with less than 25 seconds on the game clock.
Sounds kind of inadvertent to me. I don't know about you folks at home.
How about the three O's right there on Dennis Dixon? One on the helmet, two under each eye.
Will the clock operator please reset the game clock to 18 seconds, which was the time when the ready for play was given.
Zach Follett loses a sack off the official stats off after all of that.
Wow. Play doesn't count. They've still given up only one sack. And Zach back in the field says, I'm coming again. And 75. Big Jeff Schwartz says, you're not getting there this time, buddy. Running play to run out the first quarter. 14-3. The California Golden Bears lead the Oregon Ducks. 17 points on the board here. It's Saturday Night Football, ESPN style on ABC.
You're watching ESPN on ABC.
Third down and four as we start the second quarter. Jonathan Stewart's the running back. Dixon's going to throw for it in. Almost intercepted by Bishop. Did he get it? Yes, he did. Desmond Bishop with a diving interception. Another Oregon mistake.
And Cal with their second interception of the night. You're going to see Dante Rosario, the tight end, come across. A little holding there by Bishop, tugging on his back. But a great effort, actually, by Dante Bishop. It was Worrell Williams tugging on him a little bit.
When he, holds the ball up, I thought it had bounced on the ground looking at it from behind him. But what a great catch, and he held it up with one hand to show him he had it all the way. What a fine-looking linebacker he is. And now the Bears and Longshore go back to work. Another completion. Just striking fear and using Marshawn Lynch, the running back, for a first and 10 inside the 15-yard line.
And Marshawn Lynch, an excellent receiver, Brent, that time actually lined up at wide receiver and went right down the seam.
First down and 10 for the Bears. Marshawn carrying it, cut off. Let's go up close and personal with number 10, Marshawn Lynch.
Marshawn Lynch, running back, California, family first.
You know, Marshawn is family first. There's no question about it that that's his main focus.
Talk to my mom every day. Every day. I can't get her off my phone, matter of fact. She was always there when I needed her, came through in the clutch when times was rough, you know, so that's my mama.
And he does not mind being called a mama's boy, but there's a great story involving mom when she comes to these games. We're going to hear from Lisa here in a moment on this one. short of the first down, still throwing for it. It'll be third and short. Lisa, have you spotted mom here tonight?
Well, I saw his mom. She actually is in her seat right now, but Brent, usually she paces up and down the sidelines. I talked to her about it, and she says it's just nerves, but for right now, I'm going to try to sit for as long as I can, but rest assured, I will be up and pacing the sidelines at some point during the game. As you said, Brent, Marshawn Lynch is a self-described mama's boy. He has the words mama's boy tattooed on his back, and when I asked him, aren't you worried that people are going to think you're soft? He said, they can think whatever they think. I am a mama's boy. That's just the way it is.
Third down and short now. Mama's boys in that eye, and they give it to the fullback, the lead blocker, and they didn't surprise the Ducks. They ambushed Storr that time. That defensive front was ready for that attempt.
All the momentum on the side of Cal. I think Jeff Tedford's going to go for it right here.
You agree with that?
I do. I think all the momentum on his side, but now he's going to call timeout and probably overthink it a little bit now, overanalyze the situation. And the reason I say to go for it, Brent, there's going to be a lot of points tonight before this game's over.
Valid point. We'll take a break.
You're watching ESPN on ABC.
Well, there's DeLisa Lynch now watching, and the Bears are going to go for it. Her son will be in that eye behind the fullback. It is fourth and about a half yard. Here he comes. He got that first down. It'll be first down and goal for the Bears.
That's mama's boy hitting it up in there for the first down. I think an excellent call right there by Jeff Tedford early in this football game.
Yeah, baby.
Yeah. This is a great shot from right on top. I mean, he just ran over top of Dexter Manley that time. Mama wasn't sure there for a second.
No, she wanted the touchdown.
She hesitated a little bit. No, she wanted the first down. She's not greedy.
First down and goal now for the Bears. They lead it 14-3. The Ducks have made too many mistakes. That's why they're trailing right now. Couple of picks. Going to throw. Deflected, intercepted. Picked off in the end zone. Coming out on the 20-yard line. Jairus Byrd, the freshman from Clayton, Missouri, makes the interception in the end zone.
And the third tight end, David Gray, is going to come across on the crossing route. And the ball is batted by number 33, Blair Phillips. And Brent, keep in mind, that was first down and 10 as Jairus Byrd comes up with the interception for Oregon.
Now we'll see if Dixon and the Ducks can take advantage of the break. Dropped. Second down and 10. Jason Williams had one down low, but let it get away.
Three interceptions already in this football game.
Maybe Nate did know something.
Exactly.
It was going to be defense.
We kind of rolled our eyes a little bit when Nate talked about defense, but maybe we owe him an apology.
Second and 10, here comes the blitz. And that inside shovel pass off to Stewart. And Stewart to the 25-yard line. Let's check in with Matt Weiner for the first time tonight. Matt, how you doing?
Get a Taco Bell update. UCLA and Arizona, both quarterbacks in this game were injured and are now out. So it's the backup, Patrick Cowan, to Matt Willis for the Bruins. That puts them on top, 14-7. Ben Olsen out with a sprained knee.
Matt, we keep an eye on those two injuries. And here, 14-3, Cal just turned it over. Going in for a possible touchdown. Ball was loose. Ball on the ground. Bears say they've recovered it. which would be the third turnover. Let's see. They'll unpile everybody. There it is. Turnover number three. And Abu Mahafala.
I took care of that one, Coach.
Hey, I'm not going to repeat that name.
Come on, you can handle Mahafala.
I'm just going to go with number 43. But a huge turnover on third and five. He never had the handoff from the quarterback right there. And that's option football right there, because Jonathan Stewart wasn't sure he was going to get the football. And another huge turnover by this Cal defense.
First down and 10 for the Bears. Here comes Lynch. Big hole left side. Explodes. Lynch. Lynch going to the goal line. Down to the 1 yard line. Marshawn Lynch. He's hobbling a little bit. He goes down at the 20-yard line and turns a somersault. It'll be all right.
But we look at Mama's boy right here. The thing he can do, Brent, he can power you. And how about that stiff arm to the face right there? I mean, that is some strength. He put it on Patrick Chung, number 15. Well, he is limping as he comes out.
Now watch what he does here.
Wow. How about the
little
finish
pain
to it
and a
right
somersault,
there?
But he's in a little bit of pain at the end of that run. Meanwhile, we got a first and goal here for the Bears. And Justin Forsett, smaller but a talented backup, is the running back. This time they stay on the ground over the top, and the Ducks throwing back. So it'll be second down and goal. Let's take a look at the end of this, Bob. Did you see anything here?
I was distracted by that forearm to the face he put on Chung. Really hard to see right there, Brent.
Yeah, it is. He was pulling down the front of the jersey, and it may have rolled up on a leg there at the end. Who knows? Second down and goal.
You see the size difference. Justin Forsett, much smaller than Marshawn Lynch.
The quarterback keeps it. Nate Longshore.
That guy was probably a 4.0 bio med student,
yep,
or something right there being passed amongst those student bodies.
You got to be nice to these youngsters in a school like this. They could do serious damage. Nate Longshore's first rush touchdown for the California Golden Bears. A year ago, he was a starter, broke his ankle in the opener, came back this year, had the nightmare in Tennessee. He has a wonderful attitude, has rebounded well, has them ahead now. Snyder's extra point makes it 21-3. There he is. So the Bears have jumped up on the Ducks. Oregon needs a rally.
Today's singular All-American flashback, University of California defensive back Delta O'Neal. In 1999, O'Neal had 9 interceptions, 4 for touchdowns, and still an NCAA record. Text VOTE to 87654 now on your Singular wireless phone for a chance at a trip to the national championship game.
John Saunders in New York with your primetime pulse over on ESPN. Tennessee trying to creep back into this game. It's now 24-14. South Carolina still leading Kentucky 17-7 now. Thank you.
We are back with 9:55 to go here in the first half. Bob Davey and Lisa Salters. I'm Brent Musburger. Nice to have you along. There's Nate Longshore. Just took it into the end zone for the Bears. Also thrown a couple of touchdown passes in this game.
He has fun, doesn't he? He's great personality.
for a young man who suffered a tragedy in the spring when his father passed away at a very young age. We'll tell you that story. Is Jeremiah Johnson on a cutback to the right, spins, and he's down at the 26-yard line. Here's our Pacific Life game summary on a gorgeous Saturday evening here in Berkeley, California. 21-3, turnovers, turnovers, turnovers. Oregon, 3 turnovers and 4 penalties, and we still got 9:44 left in the first half, but you can't survive something like that, can you? First down and 10. Running play. Big Stewart to the 29-yard line. And, Bob, let's check out those miscues.
Brent, you said it. Particularly on the road, it's difficult to survive 3 turnovers early in this football game. Keep in mind, Oregon, 41 players on their football team from the state of California. This is a huge game as you look at the concern right there on Mike Bellotti's face.
On 2nd and 7, here's Williams. Short of the first down, they gang up on him. Brandon Hampton, number 3, the Rover, was in there. There's our red zone with South Carolina, Kentucky.
And Jason Jason Williams averaging about 17 yards a catch. Comes in number 3 nationally in yards per game with 115. They've done a good job on him, particularly Damian Hughes, number 13, matching up. You see it right here.
Try to run for it, and the Bears jumped it. The Bears were ready for that play. And Oregon will send the punt team onto the field here with 8 minutes to go in the first half. A half to forget so far for the Ducks.
You're going to see 69. Matt Malele right there, 335 pounds, with the center, Anoka Lucas. Big stop, and Brent, always fake punts a factor when you play against an Oregon football team and Mike Bellotti. And I'm sure Cal is thinking the same thing right now.
Jackson's the return man, number 1. Knowles hits it at the 25-yard line. Jackson runs up, trying to deke him. Did. Got the great speed. Out of bounds. What a great bluff that was by Jackson, who's woofing down there on his sideline.
He is a dynamic player out of Long Beach Poly, right there in the backyard of USC. Cal beat USC to recruit him. Long Beach Poly with more NFL players than any other high school in the country.
He had reason to woof. The young fellow there on the sideline pushed him down. We'll take another look at that when we come back. Okay. Well, there are some houses with a beautiful view. Strawberry Canyon, looking down on this 70,000 crowd Memorial Stadium. This is old school, folks, and due to be remodeled starting at the end of the season. For Set the running back, remember Marshawn Lynch was injured on the play that set up their touchdown. Let's go back to the sideline and let's take a look at Blair Phillips, the Mike linebacker over here on the sideline, number 33. Just a gentle little how do you do. And now watch. And he's not afraid of them big linebackers now, is he, coach? Huh?
No harm, no foul, though, right? Blair Phillips just protecting himself a little bit there on the sideline.
Now, wait a minute. Oh, wait a minute. How big is Blair Phillips? Protecting himself.
I've been run over on that sideline.
Push him down a little bit there, he did. Second down and 4. From the gun. Incomplete. Trying to put it back in Jackson's hands.
You look at DeSean Jackson. He's still John. He's still
same guy.
At it.
It absolutely started by Blair Phillips over here on the sideline. They're going to get Blair over here. They're going to bring him off in this substitution package now. Third down at 14. 24 points on the board, 6:30 to go. Long short, got a threw too high. He had Robert Jordan. Jordan was behind coverage. And it'll be fourth down. Bears will punt. Still plenty of time for the Ducks.
Nate Longshore on fire since Tennessee. That time did have his wide receiver wide open and the ball overthrown.
Jeremiah Johnson back deep. Larson from behind with the three protectors that a whole lot of folks are starting to use now. Got the hang time. Fair catch at about the 21-yard line. So Saturday Night Football on ABC presented by Southwest Airlines. The low fare from here to there. It's on Southwest Airlines at southwest.com. The new 2007 Lincoln Navigator. Singular, raising the bar. And Aflac. Ask about it at work. Gorgeous sunset here in the San Francisco Bay Area. You look out across the water over toward the city of San Francisco, Berkeley, California. First down and 10. Dixon gets plenty of time. And good coverage. Second down, the intended receiver, Brian Paysinger.
You see Oregon a little bit out of rhythm. Keep in mind, they're a fairly balanced offense, but Brent, they really want to run the ball first. They lead the Pac-10 in rushing. Right now, 21-3. They feel like they have to throw it probably a little more than they really want to.
Defensive coordinator Bob Gregory doing an excellent job against this Oregon spread tonight with the Bear defenders. Second and 10. Show blitz. Here they come. Blitz the run, and Stewart's thrown back. Zach Foley slips through on a linebacker blitz and makes the play.
Both inside linebackers come through the guard center gaps, and Zach Follett again in the backfield for another big play.
Third and 15. Deflected, incomplete. And once it's deflected like that into the middle, you know it can be picked off by somebody. So the Ducks are fortunate there. Rosario, the intended receiver. And Dennis Dixon struggling here in Berkeley tonight.
And a great look right here from Skycam. That ball was batted, as you mentioned. And how about this Cal defense, Brent? Came in ranked 91st in the country in total defense. Excellent job so far early in this game.
Jackson again with Knowles backed up inside the 5-yard line to take the snap. Cal should have wonderful field position. And there was a bear on top of Knowles. Here's Jackson dancing at the 35, trying to get a block on that side. Cuts back, looking for daylight. Got one man to beat. He explodes, end zone ahead. Touchdown, Bears. Now a late penalty flag. But it was with Jackson was going into the end zone. I think this is going to stand, but hang on here. Rosario, the tight end, was definitely involved down there. He was engaged at the 30. Tedford waiting, and he wants it thrown out. Jackson was already at the 10-yard line when it was thrown behind him.
There is no foul on the play. No foul on the play for a personal foul. The contact is unintentional.
And he did get the flag thrown out, did he?
But is this not the next Reggie Bush in this conference? You don't coach this, Brent. He takes it, reverses his field, and it gets a great block right there. And now the 4-2-9 kicks in.
His second punt return for a touchdown this year. 64 yards. He told us yesterday, when I said, how could you get away from Pete Carroll in Southern California? When they hone in, they usually get everybody. He said, I just wanted to leave Southern California and go to school someplace else. He said that was the only reason. No negatives involved whatsoever. Love it up here in Cal. And it's 28-3. 625-plus yard touchdowns this year. Mr. Dynamic of the California Bears. It's 28-3.
You're watching ESPN on ABC.
Well, when we said we're going to go to 60, we didn't realize that Jeff Tedford's Bears were going to put 50 on the board. They lead it 28-3 right now, and we're going to show you Jeff Tedford was very upset here,
Bob. And here's what we're going to get, I believe, right here, Dante Rosario. If we let this run, right there. Did you see it? He jumped in the air and kicked the Cal player, and they see the flag come out. How can you put that flag back in your pocket?
That's unbelievable.
That was unbelievable. I mean,
remember
number 44.
When he threw his thumb in the air? He had a perfect view of it, and he wanted Rosario tossed out of the game. It wasn't picked the flag up, and now Johnson returns it to the 25-yard line.
And Jeff Tedford has a legitimate point. I'm going to watch right there. Right there. He clearly jumped in the air and kicked that Cal player, and the flag comes
out. Watch this.
That's exactly what he did. That's a legitimate argument right there.
Especially when the official throws
yeah,
the flag.
Yeah, how can you put the flag back in your pocket after that?
Especially when we had that ugly, ugly incident involving, was it Haynesworth of the Titans and the Dallas Cowboys? I mean, that's got to be fresh in everybody's mind.
Offside, kicking team. Receiving team has elected to have the 5-yard penalty enforced from the end of their run. First down.
Well, the Ducks, Dennis Dixon trailing 28-3. Oregon has self-destructed, turning it over three times, allowing a punt return for a touchdown. Option. Pitch to Stewart, who dives ahead to the 36. Now, Marshawn Lynch was shaken up on a run to the 1-yard line, and he's going off to the locker room here early. Second down at 5. Ducks would love to strike it. First and 10. And the receiver was Finley, as we check in with Lisa.
Well, Brent, as you recall, a couple of minutes ago, Marshawn Lynch, that play on the 1-yard line, he says that the player fell on his leg. At first, the trainers were working on his right ankle, but he says it's an entire right leg. And I know that because he walked over to the fan section and started hugging and talking to his family members. He said he just wanted to consult them about whether he should go back into the game or not. I said, you guys are up pretty big. He goes, not big enough. I want to get back in there. But obviously, he's in a lot of pain. Brent.
First and 10, and a jarring hit on Rosario. Little bit of payback there by the Bears' Zach Follett, who unloaded on the tight end after that reception.
And I mean, Zach Follett right now, the defensive player of the game so far, that is a lick right there.
Second down and 3. Ducks trying to drive in. Option look. Pitch dives for the first down. using Stewart. Well, Jeff Tedford, he's been a master with quarterbacks through the years. Time for our Aflac trivia question. How many first-round NFL quarterbacks has California head coach Jeff Tedford coached? The only hint I'll give you is remember he was at Fresno State for a while before he went to Oregon and then came down to California. Just go ahead and see if you can jot down the names, okay? How many do you come up with? First down and 10 for the Ducks. Lucas shaken up early, still over the ball at center. He returned after missing a couple of plays. Touchdown would be huge for Oregon late here in the half. Dancing to the left. He'll keep it. Now he's got the first down. He saw that it was open, and he picked up the first down and then danced out of bounds. 15 yards.
No question the ability of Dennis Dixon right here. Stays in bounds, gets what he can get, and then get out of bounds. Smart guy, Brent, 4.0 student in the spring semester at Oregon, Dennis Dixon.
Leading rusher for the Ducks. He's rushed for 36 and Stewart for 25. Jeremiah Johnson is a running back. He throws the block. The throw back, Williams drops it. Incomplete pass. Second down and 10, and Williams got the dropsies on a couple of balls, and he said, my fault. That's his second.
Jason Williams, early in his career, that was the knock on him. A little inconsistent catching the football. They thought he was through that phase, but let's be honest, Oregon not playing very well right now offensively by any stretch of the imagination.
After exploding at Arizona State last week, they've come up limping here in Berkeley so far, haven't they? But plenty of time. 2:41 now. Dixon slides down short of the first down. And the most dangerous weapon they've had in this drive, his feet.
And this is an offense, as we look at the concern on Mike Bellotti's face, over 500 yards, Brent, against Oklahoma, Arizona State, and Stanford. And the one that jumps out at you, over 500 on a very fast Oklahoma defense.
Three wide receivers for Dixon. Third down and 7. Johnson now gives him a fourth out to the right. Sacked. The Bears swarm all over him. Pimentel, number 8, Mickey Pimentel, the senior from San Diego, credited with it.
Anytime you go no backs, empty, Brent, you have 5 blockers. That time, Bob Gregory and Cal brings 6 rushers and gets the sack off the corner.
A long field goal attempt coming up here. And Matt Evanson, and it's a fake. The throw, got it. First and goal, and there you are, Bob Davey. You called it as Rosario makes the catch. Anytime you're dealing with Bellotti, you've got to watch the fake kicks.
And Brent, they hit him on the sidelines. Dante Rosario at 250 pounds. He's over there on the sidelines. Nobody from Cal saw him.
And Brady Leaf, the holder, comes up throwing.
That was a well-executed play. You're going to see him right here at the bottom of the screen. And Cal late reacting. Huge play by Mike Bellotti and that coaching staff. That was a heck of a fake right
there. Ball spotted right inside the 1 yard line. Stewart, the big back, is back in right next to Dixon. Stewart and loses yardage.
Brent, the disadvantage of the spread offense, the ball on the goal line, Oregon in the shotgun, running sideways east and west. That's my one problem with the spread.
California will call a timeout, and with 1:02 to go, let's check back on that Aflac now. Remember the question we asked you about Jeff Tedford at Fresno, Oregon, and Cal. How many first-round NFL quarterbacks has he coached? Did you write down 6 names? If you did, you're right. Remember Trent Dilfer when he was an assistant down there? How about Akili Smith when he went to Oregon? Then Carr came out, remember, and he had spent some time with him when he was on the Fresno staff. And then following that, Joey Harrington, Kyle Bowler, and of course, Rodgers is now with the Green Bay Packers, all six drafted in the first round.
And there's always the argument or the points brought up, Brent, why don't these guys have more success at the next level in the NFL? My point is that makes Jeff Tedford even a better college football coach because maybe he coaches them to the highest degree of their ability and develops them to the point there's not much development left.
You know, very comparable with Steve Spurrier. If you go back and look at the quarterback Spurrier turned out at Florida, and of course we have to hold on because Rex Grossman playing very well for the Chicago Bears as he takes over that team. But a lot of the Gator quarterbacks who set records for Spurrier did not set the NFL on fire. At any rate, we got second and goal. It's Saturday Night Football here. And Stewart pounds to the end zone for the touchdown. Jonathan Stewart's fifth touchdown of the season. The Pac-10's leading rusher.
And the thing you love, Brent, they put the quarterback under the center. They put a lead blocker in there. They went to the I formation and pounded it in. But go back to the fake field goal, a trademark of Mike Bellotti coached football teams.
Now this is a trademark, too, on the extra point. They'll swing the gate over. And believe me, they've got plays out of that also. But here, you would think that the percentage. And Evanson. He tacks on the extra point. And we've got time for a prime time pulse. So let's check in with John Saunders. John.
Thanks, Prentice. We remind everyone that over on ESPN, Tennessee looked like they were going to be blown up, but they're down by just three now as they started to come back. And meanwhile, South Carolina's 17-0 lead is down to 17-10. That one is over on ESPN2. Brent, back to you.
All right, John, thank you. And here it is 28-10. And with time running out, a minute. Four left here in the first half, but that should give the Ducks a big lift here. Back.
That was a huge lift, Brent, right before the end of the first half. And for those fans sitting out there that haven't watched a lot of Pac-10 football, don't leave because there's going to be a bunch more points in this football game tonight.
We've already had 38. And I said at the top of the show we were headed into the 60s. And we may even make the 70s with this bunch. Nate Longshore, a couple of touchdown passes tonight. He's also rushed for his first touchdown for the Bears. O'Keefe and Hughes are back to return and on the ground. Takes a high hop. One of the wedgemen returns to the 34-yard line. And a reminder now, the 9, which is getting solid reviews, Wednesday at 10, 9 Central. It's all new right after Lost. And USA Today, you may have seen that story, 4 stars and called it the best new show of the year. 9, so it's on Wednesday and only on ABC. Now, we mentioned Nate Longshore, and a week after the spring game, his father, Todd, passed away in tragic circumstances. Nate told me yesterday he was gardening, took an ugly fall, a nasty elbow injury, and a blood clot set in, and he died at a very young age. And his mother and daughter here, and I asked Nate, I said, how you holding up? And he said, you know, it's been tough, but that's just part of life, and you've got to go on. I know that Pops would want me to keep on playing and came back to school. He's a Mormon youngster, has not gone on mission. He'll do that after he finishes up here. 6 of 13 tonight. Pair of touchdown passes. So Nate Longshore, and he's a big rascal now. 6'5", 280, 233. And he looks like he's got a solid future. He's just a wonderful personality. And there's the backup running back, Forsett, dashing for the first down. 2 seconds showing on that clock.
How about Forsett with 999 yards last year, Brent? You think they could have gotten him one more yard to make 1,000, don't you?
Absolutely. Well, they're going to let time run out. 38 point, 28-10. Now, let's send it to New York. Big John, Doug Flutie, and my man, Craig James. Take it away, John.
Does anybody have more fun than Brett Musburger doing a football game? The uniforms had us confused, I think, before the game started in this one. But what have you seen from this first half?
I think that maybe Oregon's players are confused with the color of their jerseys, too, that they think Cal's their teammate. This is really a game that surprised me quite a bit. I thought that Oregon's defense was a lot better than they are. Cal's offense, Jeff Tedford told us several weeks ago, we found our quarterback, Longshore, and he's showing us improving himself right now.
He's playing well. He's not throwing up huge numbers, but he's thrown a couple of big touchdown passes, made the plays he's had to make. The big key of the game was the first interception returned by Cal and set up the touchdown, and it just – started off on the wrong foot, went downhill, and now Oregon is getting their act together.
You know, Mike Bellotti at the end of the half, a little trick play, gets his team back into the game as well. Now, the number two team in the nation starting the day was Auburn facing Arkansas. Tommy Tuberville, he's had an undefeated season and come away with no hardware. Arkansas quarterback Mitch Mustain, 50 yards to Marcus Monk.
I guess he didn't read the article this week and all the publicity stunts by Coach Tuberville saying they got to be ready to play for the national championship. The team read too many articles.
Brandon Cox tries to lead them back.
I'll tell you what, throwing off the back foot with a guy in his face, not a bad throw. Great job by the receiver pulling that one in.
But Felix Jones from a yard out, and Arkansas, 27-10 is the win over the second-ranked team in the nation. How good is this Hogs team?
Well, Arkansas's good. There's no doubt about that. But what really was surprising was how much they ran the football. This was just a powerful team. This was a game where Auburn's defense got manhandled out there, and I can't believe that.
They took it 279 yards on the ground for Arkansas to 60.
Wow.
All right. I mean, they took it to them. They didn't just win a game and get lucky. They took it to them.
Gashed them.
3-0 in the conference.
The last time they went undefeated was because they could run the football like crazy with two guys out of the backfield. Stick around. When we come back, we'll check scores and highlights from around the rest of the nation, including some more SEC contests and a couple of big ones in the Big Ten. You're watching ESPN on ABC. You're also watching DeSean Jackson take this one 65 yards on a punt return. Goes left, goes right, sees the spot opening, takes off and takes it for the touchdown. Cal with a 28-10 lead at halftime. John Saunders, Craig James, and Doug Flutie here. We'll get you out to the second half in a moment, but we showed you a great one in the SEC from before. Another one today, Tennessee against Georgia, with another SEC team trying to remain unbeaten, and that is Georgia. Mikey Henderson, 86 yards on this punt return for a touchdown.
Well, first of all, Georgia started out well on offense, which surprised me. The fans were in it. This punt return really got Georgia fans into the game, and that's been what's really helped this team stay in the ballgame.
It was 17-7 at that point. Joe Tereshinski's been waiting for his time, and here it is.
He's back on the field. You have a senior leader on the field directing this offense, and they're going in the right direction. They're scoring points today. Tennessee is getting back in that game.
Yeah, they were down by 14. They got it down. Florida quarterback Tim Tebow, one of the more interesting passes I've seen in my life.
The double clutch jump pass, you know it. Come on.
Tebow this time steps up and then fires to Lewis Murphy.
Defenses are so keyed in on Tebow running the ball that whenever he's in the game, they're up there for it. Pull-up play action is a great weapon for him now.
How do you like these numbers for Tim Tebow? Two passes attempted, two passes completed for two touchdowns. Not bad. And a rushing
and
TD.
And his attitude, man, there were a couple times he went in there. One of those touchdowns rushing, everybody knew. They knew it at LSU. Florida knew it up front. We're going to run Tebow right up the middle, and y'all can't stop us or see if you can. And that's what his attitude, man, is contagious.
It was obvious by formation what they were doing. And everybody just – and he sticks his nose in there and runs like a fullback.
What does this do for Chris Leak, though?
I think they've accepted the role. Chris Leak has had a great year. He leads him. He's got all these numbers, passing efficiency-wise, touchdown passes-wise. He is secure. But what it does is add another dimension to this offense, especially with him running the ball in third and short situations and avoids the big hits now on Leak.
You and I have a little bit disagreed on this thing here because I know you say you don't want to have a quarterback that looks over his shoulder, but I really believe this is a situation where Tebow in practice and in the games is making Leak better because he's pushing him. I think Leak's a competitor. He wants to be on that field. He does not want to give up snaps, and he knows that if he doesn't focus and play his darn best, he's not going to be there. So that kind of energy on the team, they feel it.
And you've been on both sides of that shoulder, haven't you?
I would want to be in Leak's
this
position.
This is a positive situation,
yeah.
And it's obvious that Tebow is going to be the guy
All right, the Red River rivalry played today between Texas and Oklahoma. Adrian Peterson, you figured he would be the key player in this game. It looked that way early, 29 yards on this touchdown run.
Well, Texas offense scored early, and then Peterson answered the bell, and the OU defense going in at halftime had total control of the game. But the Texas offensive line came out, and they started protecting, and they gave Colt McCoy time to throw the ball.
Just a couple of big plays. A play action there hits the fade with a beautiful throw, and he comes back with a third down pass here down by the goal line, perfectly feathered in over the top. He made a couple of big throws, but the thing that won this game for him, I thought, was the Texas defense and defensive line controlling Peterson, not allowing him to get off in the
good
second
job.
Half.
Good job, Colt McCoy. He did his job. I didn't think he could do it.
And you knew the winner of this game would be a team with one loss, still very much in the hunt for the national championship. Coming up, we're going to take a look at what Michigan did, what Ohio State did, and much more. This is ESPN on ABC. Back in New York to update you that New Yorkers are not very happy because the Yankees get swept out by the Tigers after winning the first game 8-3. So the Tigers will go on to face the Oakland A's in the ALCS. John Saunders, Craig James, and Doug Flutie. Let's get you back to college football right now. The battle, of course, is not for who's number one. We know that's Ohio State. It's for who's number two. Is it USC? Michael McDonald takes a snap and throws 20 yards on this fake field goal to Steve Smith. They have a 7-0 lead, but John David Booty has emerged as a leader of this team.
Well, he's emerged as a leader, but he's also a guy that's recognizing there's lots of players on that football team who can score, like always.
Washington played him tough. West Virginia, Mississippi State, Steve Slayton with big day.
Huge day for Slayton again, running. The West Virginia, you have to make West Virginia throw the football. Stack the box, do whatever you have to do. East Carolina had the idea, make Pat White beat you throwing the ball.
They get Mississippi State, knock them off today. Bowling Green against Ohio State. The number one team in the nation would not buckle. Troy Smith, 11 yards to Ray Small. 28-7 at that point. And then these are the ones you like to see. Troy Smith to Ted Ginn Jr.
You know what? Ginn Jr., we've said it time and time again. When he gets behind somebody, Troy Smith finds him. These are two good friends. And today was a typical Ohio State Buckeye day. Just swap the opponent.
Setting up that Ohio State-Michigan game. Loy Carr says we can remain unbeaten as well. We knock off Michigan State. Chad Henne. Watch his catch by Adrian Arrington.
Boy, it's making the quarterback look good.
I'll tell you what, between Mario Manningham and Adrian Arrington, they have two of the top receivers in the country. There are how many big 6'4", 6'5", receivers are there out there right now?
Another great tip ball.
I think right about now that even you are going to have to move Michigan into your top five. But West Virginia, where do they rank right now? They weren't that impressive today.
Well, they weren't that impressive. What, are you kidding me? I mean, they went into an SEC conference school and went out there and smacked them around. Are you kidding me? That's
wins.
What they needed to do. West Virginia has been falling off the radar. They took advantage of an SEC opponent, went out there and just put them in the woodshed and smoked them.
I like the way Michigan's playing right now, and Chad Henne is throwing the football. He doesn't get cheated on his touchdown passes. He's throwing it down the field. Granted, the last one was tipped, but in general, he's slinging it down the field.
Auburn lost. We'll have to move Michigan
up. I was going to say, an SEC opponent without a win in their conference as well. You're watching ESPN on ABC.
You can't come to Berkeley in the shadow of San Francisco without a little background music from the Grateful Dead. Expect to see Bill Walton walking down to the sideline. 28-10, California leading Oregon. And it's time, Coach, for our Southwest Airlines defensive playbook.
Well, the Cal defense has been impressive. And anytime you're on the road as Oregon's the visitor and you turn the ball over, Brent, on the first play of the game, it's hard to recover from that. But this Cal defense, two interceptions and a fumble recovery. But I go back to the first offensive play of the game, and Oregon threw that interception. Tough to dig out of that hole because you lose just so much confidence on the road.
But Oregon has enough firepower to climb back in?
No question. No question. And the fake field goal at the end of the first half was huge for Oregon.
Yeah, Brady Leaf, the holder and the backup quarterback, He rose up and threw a strike to Rosario, and that set up their touchdown. We've got a sellout crowd, folks, here in Berkeley. We've got 72,516. Strawberry Canyon's alive. O'Keefe and Hughes are back deep to return. And if you just snapped on your set, yep, those are the Bears in their brand spanking new jerseys. First time out of the box, and they're going to bring it out with O'Keefe. And O'Keefe crosses the 20 and down at about the 23-yard line in our Pacific Life game summary here. Coach, what do you see?
The biggest thing to me, we've talked about, obviously, the turnovers and then the points off of turnovers right there. Yardage-wise, no question Oregon can move the football out, gain Cal 183 to 161. But the turnovers, particularly on the road, killed Oregon.
The biggest negative for the Bears is the fact that Marshawn Lynch went to the locker room early, and we see that Justin Forsett is opening at running back for the Bears. So he's behind Nate Longshore. Deshaun Jackson, their speedy wide receiver, already has returned a punt for a touchdown tonight. Timed in 4-2-9. Longshore going to put it up to start the second half. Oh. Caught beautifully by number one, Deshaun Jackson. Speed kills, folks, over and over again.
And you see the red shirt freshman corner, Walter Thurman, one-on-one, and Nate Longshore, Brent, checked to that play immediately when he saw one-on-one coverage. And what a catch. This is a dynamic young football player.
41 yards. He has 77 receiving, and the long punt return for set to the 33-yard line. And when you take a look at this pass chart, he sprays it all over the field.
Well, the thing that jumps out is how well he throws the deep ball. Look at those deep zones. He hasn't thrown an incompletion down the field tonight.
They are making a statement, and I dare say it's being heard loud and clear down in Southern California. When the Bears come a-calling, that's going to be some football game down at the Coliseum between USC and the Bears. Second down and one. Forsett has jumped that time beautifully. Toena got a hand on him and ripped him down.
Brent, I know it's only one play, but you start this football game on the road, you throw an interception. You regroup at halftime, you come out in the second half, and you give up the big pass. It may be only one play, but the first play of the game and the first play of the second half are critical.
Left unsaid by the Bears coaching staff and players, they were rather quiet around us about it. But it is clear that they were embarrassed by Tennessee, and they couldn't wait to go back under the bright lights. Doing it again, out of bounds, incomplete. Out of bounds is Lavelle Hawkins.
Oregon dodged a bullet because, Brent, that was a broken coverage right there. And Lavelle Hawkins just caught the ball out of bounds, but he was wide open early on that route.
Tom Schneider on for the long field goal. Ayoub, backup quarterback's the holder. 44 yards for Schneider. We've already had one fake field goal tonight.
Oregon has blocked two kicks on the season, Brent.
They were coming after that one. Perfect, got it. 31-10, Cal. The Bears running away from the Ducks, but there's a lot of time left. California, Northern California. And if you come to this state, you got to talk about the fault lines. And the Hayward Fault runs right underneath Bob David. And then it crosses under Lisa Salter. I'm safe. I'm on the other side. But, folks, when you see this, you just kind of want to turn away. Look at how it's separated and is being held together there.
You want to switch sides?
No, you stay right there. You got me covered. massive remodeling job will begin right at the end of this season. Out behind us where the television trucks are parked. They will have a roof over a brand new, beautiful weight room, offices, meeting rooms, and an Olympic workout facility. Great all-around athletics here in California. Johnson, the return man. And he makes his way just short of the 30-yard line. And Lisa, Coach Bellotti, I know you had a chance to talk to him and find out about Marshawn Lynch. What's the latest?
That's right, Brent. I asked Oregon head coach Mike Bellotti what went right on that late touchdown drive to end the half that maybe wasn't going on earlier in the half. And he said we had a better rhythm, better tempo, but of course we didn't make any mistakes. We didn't turn the ball over. Bottom line, he said, I told my guys at halftime, stop being so user-friendly. We got to stop giving them the ball. Update on Marshawn Lynch. Cal officials have told me that he is going to play. He was out here a little bit earlier warming up. He's going to try to give it a go. Right.
All right, Lisa, thank you. Dixon and the Ducks attempting to rally. Kent picks up a first down, and he's out to the 45-yard line with Desmond Bishop, very active linebacker. Marshawn getting serious when you put the helmet on the side, huh, Coach?
I think he'll be back. What helps Oregon in this game, Brent? I know it's 31-10, but they are a no-huddle offense. I think they need to pick the tempo up a little bit on the no-huddle and get that ball snapped a little quicker.
They have been shadowing Jason Williams with Damian Hughes, the corner, throughout the evening. Now they throw in underneath to Kent again to midfield, and we've got an update coming our way. Let's check in with Matt.
A game-changing performance of the day. The old ball coach digging deep into the old playbook. The double reverse option pass. Kenny McKinley to Savelle Newton. The Gamecocks up by 7 late in Kentucky. To vote for your Pontiac game-changing performance, go to ESPN.com.
All right, Matt, I've got a vote for you, my friend. The blocked field goal by Clemson against Wake Forest in the fourth quarter. I think Clemson put 24 up on the board, and they were in danger of losing that game. If you haven't seen it, folks, switch over to SportsCenter or ESPN to catch it. Catch it on your local news. It's a heck of a play.
I've got one, too. The fourth down pass interference in overtime on Minnesota that gave Penn State the first down and ultimately won the football game for the Nittany Lions.
Third and 6. Joe Pa finally got one to fall his way. He didn't have to chase down that referee. Shuttle pass inside. Here comes Stewart trying to get the first down. Muscles for it. He's a good-looking back. Jonathan Stewart. How big did you say he is, Brian?
234 pounds, and that was a great effort because he was actually hit in the backfield, if you look initially. Right there, he runs through the tackle of number 10, Desmond Bishop. Benches 410 pounds. Great calves and lower body. How about those calves?
Looks like a linebacker, doesn't he? He's built there.
And you see the special tape on the right ankle. Has had an ankle injury all year. Wears a special shoe called the Michael Vick shoe from Nike that only Michael Vick wears because of the ankle problem.
And Stewart missed that block, and that Vick and Dixon has to slide downfield. Well, Michael never had to throw a block either, did he? Now he's a good-looking football player.
Out of the state of Washington, some people had him ranked the number 2 recruit in the country coming out of high school.
We've got over 10 minutes now. Down 3 scores. Second down. Back in the gun. Pocket holds, goes down sideline, incomplete, and he wanted Williams. And you could see the coverage by Damian Hughes, who has 5 interceptions this year, and he's returned 2 of them for touchdowns.
And some people say Damian Hughes, the number 1 corner in the country. Great confidence right there. You say the big receiver, Jason Williams, pushing on a little bit. But anytime you have a lockdown corner and you can take the other team's leading receiver out of the game, that's a huge advantage.
Yeah, that was part of Coach Gregory's scheme all week long. Williams with 2 catches for 18 yards, and there is Stewart, and a great tackle by Hughes.
Thank you.
And Brent, Jason Williams at 6'5", 240. Watch. He has a chance to make a block out here on the option. And Damian Hughes just whips him. You know, the great wide receivers not only make plays catching the ball, but they make plays blocking. That was a big miss block right there by Jason Williams.
Fourth down and a six. Aaron Knowles, the punter tonight. From behind him. Fair catch is the signal. They'll let it go on into the end zone. Well, folks, Jessica Simpson. She's a season ticket holder here at Berkeley. She doesn't even know it. We've got that story when you come back.
Saturday Night Football on ABC, presented by Southwest Airlines. The low fare from here to there. It's on Southwest Airlines at southwest.com. Pacific Life, for insurance, annuities, and investments. Choose Pacific Life, the power to help you succeed. Cadillac. And Capital One, what's in your wallet?
The very well-known Telegraph Avenue here. And folks are talking college football these days around Cal. 72,516 sellout at Memorial Stadium. The Bears lead it 31-10. And here is Nate Longshore completing another pass. Now, Nate Longshore leaves two tickets for Jessica Simpson for every game.
I mean, you know, you start out with one little thing, and then before you know it, it becomes this big ordeal. But, I mean, if it's going to get her to come, I'm all for it. So, I mean, I do leave a couple tickets for her for every game in case she feels like swinging through Strawberry Canyon. If she comes, we'll show her a good time for sure. And, you know, maybe she'll decide she wants to watch a little football.
He promised me he'd leave two at the Coliseum in the USC game.
He's a good-looking guy. He's got no shot. None.
Even, what
she hangs with a completely different crowd.
But by the way, maybe he'll be a first-round draft choice.
I'm telling you, no shot. Is that a great story?
It's wonderful. Well, you know, Jerry Glanville, my old buddy, who's assistant coach with Hawaii, he always left two for Elvis, right?
Well, it's a better idea to leave two for Jessica Simpson and Elvis. I'll give you that.
I'd say third down now coming up. Third down and four. For Nate Longshore and the Golden Bears. Protected pocket, throws in underneath. Needed to get to the 30-yard line for the first down. That's Forsett. And we still have not seen the return yet, have we, of Marshawn Lynch. Got the first down.
You look at Nate Longshore. I think a big part of recovering from that Tennessee shock the first game of the year, Brent, is because of this kid's personality, which I think permeates this entire Cal football team. He's such a positive guy that I think he can put anything behind him. And I think because of his personality, they were able to put the Tennessee game behind him right away.
Really a solid point here. First down and 10 and incomplete. It'll be second down 10. And because I asked him after the interview, we were just talking, and I said, you know, how quickly did it take you to recover? He said, listen, I really enjoyed myself at Knoxville. He said, what a great scene that was. He said, I didn't play well, but he said, we got time to put it back together. He wasn't bleeding over that performance at all.
Just a positive outlook, and what a great coaching job by Jeff Tedford to bring that football team back because they got shocked in Knoxville now.
And this will not surprise anybody. Jeff Tedford told us, I'd love to play Tennessee again. Especially out here in Berkeley. Second down and 10 now. Dropping it off to Follett. There's another first down. He's got some burst to the 45 and four set to the 45-yard line.
Interesting story about Justin. He was going to go to Notre Dame. And Notre Dame actually pulled the scholarship late. And he ended up going to Cal. But we mentioned earlier, 999 yards last year in a backup role. That's a pretty strong performance. Probably start anywhere else in the country.
Marcus O'Keefe has checked in at running back. So it's possible with this lead that Tedford's not going to send Lynch back into the game.
Going to go long. Got a man open. Juggle incomplete. Lavelle Hawkins, who had a big day, or I should say, let me check that. Robert Jordan was the intended receiver, and he dropped it.
You talk about team speed. Again, they find Walter Thurman, the redshirt freshman. Wow. Wow. But the team speed of this Cal football team, Brent, you can't throw it any better than that.
Let six get away, didn't he? He's a junior from nearby Hayward.
The skill players on this Cal football team are impressive.
Second and 10. Longshore back in the gun. That's what Coach Dunbar brought from Northwestern, and the flag flies prior to the whistle. Let's talk about Mike Dunbar. He was the offensive coordinator at Northwestern, moved in because Jeff wanted to get a little bit of spread offense. And, of course, the biggest thing, the biggest change is he put the shotgun in. And Coach Tedford telling us, we're not going to spread the field with four wide receivers. That's not going to happen here. We're still going to play our offense.
And a great point. Mike Dunbar comes from Northwestern, where they are a true spread offense, similar to Oregon. But the only thing that Jeff Tedford took from that package, really, as you mentioned, is the shotgun. And I think that really helps Nate Longshore. And you take a look at Mike Dunbar right here on the right. He put together some prolific offenses at Northwestern.
He sure did. Second down and 15. Draw play. And O'Keefe. Marcus O'Keefe.
We also have to mention Mike Dunbar is calling the plays. First time Jeff Tedford really hasn't called the plays. You got to give Jeff a lot of credit for turning that over.
Well, down south, of course, we mentioned that Kirk Herbstreit's been down there checking out the SEC. We're going to be checking in with him here shortly, get a little bit of overview on what went on down south. A little bit of a shakeup, that huge upset of Auburn. And number two certainly up for grabs. USC gets forced to the wall. Forsett back on the field. And timeout has been called by the Bears. So when we come back, we will talk to Mr. Herbstreit. He's been watching our game here. There's our guy down in Gainesville. Kirk Herbstreit coming up when we continue here on Saturday Night Live.
John Saunders in New York with your Sports Center 30 at 30 update. First of all, a number two team in the nation falls. Auburn losing to Arkansas. Darren McFadden had 145 yards rushing, including that touchdown. And the Tigers beat the Yankees to go on to face the A's in the ALCS.
5:47 remaining in the third quarter. In California with a third down and a 31-10 lead. Third and seven for Longshore and the gang. Over the middle, picked up another first down, went right back to Craig Stevens, his tight end. He scored the Bears' first touchdown tonight.
Craig Stevens, the big tight end, a great little head and shoulder move to the outside and then beat him back inside. Little pump fake by Longshore. Kid's strong in the pocket, Brent. Big, strong quarterback that just stands in there in the face of that pressure.
First down and 10. They go with the running play, and we bring in Mr. Herbstreit from down there in Gainesville. And Kirk, tell us about what went on today in the SEC. What does it mean that Auburn was upset by Arkansas and Florida got through?
Well, obviously, Auburn losing today was not a fluke. Arkansas put on a clinic, guys, on both sides of the ball in the trenches. Darren McFadden had a good game, and their young freshman quarterback continues to look good. But here in Gainesville, I think Florida made a strong case, beating LSU, beating Alabama, beating Tennessee earlier in the year. They're the number two team in the country right now behind Ohio State.
Second down and five. Now, you have touted Michigan for the last couple of weeks. Are you suddenly off the Wolverine bandwagon now? Or do I see you're jumping? At Southern Hospitality do that to you today?
I'm not jumping, Brent, but what I saw today in this atmosphere, I just was really impressed. Not to mention, we kept talking about Florida's schedule. I personally didn't think they could continue to get through some of these teams. The fact that they have beaten now LSU, Alabama, and Tennessee, I think you just have to recognize the competition. I'd have Michigan right behind Florida, but right now Florida, who goes to Auburn next week, I would definitely put in at number two.
So here we've got third and three for the Bears. Longshore got another first down. And that time he did hit Lavelle Hawkins, who had the big game against Oregon State.
And Kirk, you missed it. Big time seafood dinner last night, and Brent picked up the tab. So you missed a heck of a spread out here on the bay. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh.
And how about those
I wish I could have been there.
Oh, I know. We thought of you. But how about the USC
Trojans?
That's
worth the triple O.
Yeah.
Oh, man. How about USC, guys, the last 2 weeks really finding a way late in very, very fortunate today against Washington. I thought the officials in the Pac-10 really blew it for Tyrone Willingham, not giving his offense enough time there late to get set up to run a play. That was officiating. They deserve to have that last play.
They're on first down, and Longshore is on the money going right back to Hawkins. Twice in a row he has hit him. And, Kirk, I know you've had a chance to watch our game down there. What's your impression? Are you really surprised about what the Bears have done here? I know, because I watched game day. You were talking about Oregon. You thought they might pull it off here.
Yeah, I thought there'd be more of a shootout. I thought Oregon's offense would be able to score against Cal. Obviously, Cal at night, you knew their fans would be fired up. Oregon's not been able to get on anything in rhythm offensively. But the thing about Cal is they are great on offense, but I think they're showing that they can play some defense tonight. But let's put DeSean Jackson in the Heisman discussion. That guy is a player, and he's as good as there is in college football.
Going for the first down mark that time, Justin Forsett. Bring the replay back here, and Kirk from Gainesville, take it for us.
Well, they've been showing speed, and Coach Davey's been talking about this, being able to bounce the ball to the outside. And even with Marshawn Lynch down, that's the difference this year with Jeff Tedford's team, is the depth that they now have. They can sustain a few injuries, and Forsett, who's really been coming on last year and even into this year, gives them that depth in the backfield and a nice tandem of backs that that the Cal Bears have. But there's just too much speed on the field right now for Oregon to deal with.
And Kirk, what impresses me the most, it looks like Cal's going to escape Lee Corso's double whammy. He picked them to win the national championship. They lose to Tennessee. Then I see he picked them tonight. I thought he gave him the kiss of death, and I think that he's going to they're going to escape that, I think.
But it's still early now. You know, he'll pick them to win forever. So there's still a chance that the Malokia eye, as he says, could still come back to haunt him.
You know, Kirk, mentioning the Heisman Trophy, there's a young man that I think has been overlooked, and he's really thrown the ball well, and that's Chad Henne up at Ann Arbor. I know we're going to see him next week at Happy Valley.
Yeah.
Well, I really have been impressed with how he's throwing.
You know what, Brent, when you talk to the Michigan people, not only Henne, the way he's throwing the football, but the leadership. And I think that's been the biggest difference this year for Michigan. As a group, there's more continuity. They seem more determined. And I think Mike Hart running and Chad Henne throwing and the leadership, the intangibles, have been key.
And a reach back for the touchdowns, the young man who dropped it. Robert Jordan comes back after dropping a sure touchdown pass and picks up the six. Way to go, young Mr. Jordan. That'll make him feel good, Bobby.
And again, the speed and quickness in the open field of these Cal skill players. And Brent, this is a totally, totally different team than the nation saw in Knoxville the first game of the year. They put that game behind them, and I think they have a legitimate shot to unseat USC as a Pac-10 champion.
Tommy Schneider will attempt the extra point. This is a very impressive California performance here tonight. So it's 38-10, but we've got a flag down, so hang on here just a second. And then we're going to be taking a look at the top 10 and see how it all shook out here. And with Oregon, of course, poised to jump into the top 10, and now they'll fall back the way things look, although there's still time for a big-time rally, but they're just not getting the ball down the field and making too many mistakes. Yeah, there they go again, huh? We checked the penalties over there. They've had at least five here tonight. And take a look here, Coach.
You're going to get a personal foul. One of the Oregon rushers jumps on the back of a Cal offensive lineman. Right there, you are not allowed to use the offensive player as a springboard. Number 45, Matt Tuena. That's an obvious call right there.
Let's take a look at the ESPNU All-State standings review that I mentioned here. As we await the kickoff, and there are, of course, the Buckeyes. They defended number one. Auburn's going to take the fall. And Kirk is thinking that Florida's going to jump up. What about West Virginia, Kirk? They're just simply not getting any respect. Is it because of the schedule?
Yeah, I think it is. I think people are kind of holding out, waiting to see West Virginia and Louisville. I think Louisville will move up a lot this week in the polls now that they've remained unbeaten, continue to be impressive despite the injuries. But I think West Virginia and Louisville, the jury is still out waiting for that game. I've been really disappointed in USC. I think Cal now is clearly the best team at this point in the Pac-10, and SC needs to continue to develop on offense. They've been very fortunate to escape and stay unbeaten in these first 5 weeks.
Hey, Kirk, you remember that Sports Center spring football special we did in like late May or early June, when you picked Notre Dame as the national champion, and I, by the way, picked Florida as the national champion, and everybody kind of rolled their eyes. I just wanted to make sure you had the kind of memory that could remember that.
Yeah, we're all keeping score. Okay. We're all keeping track. All right, and you know what? You're doing a great job, because I don't know if many people thought they could get through that schedule, but you did. I didn't.
Those
you
memories.
Did.
I can't remember what I said yesterday. These guys are remembering months ago of what they're picking. Yeah. This is unbelievable, folks. How about the Heisman race now? Still Troy Smith, Kirk, clearly number one.
I think it's still Troy Smith, but there's so much football to be played. I think there are guys that, even like DeSean Jackson, I think he deserves a lot of recognition. Calvin Johnson, another big game for Georgia Tech today. Adrian Peterson continues to impress, even though OU lost to Texas. So, and I think next week when we go to Happy Valley, Mike Hart is a guy who people are talking about. And down here, Chris Leak of the Florida Gators.
And we got a first and 10 now. Indeed it is. Dixon. And that time he hits Williams, going out of bounds on that far side. And, number 13, Hughes for the Bears, Bob. He has played a spectacular game defensively.
I think he's one of the best corners, if not the best corner in the country. Interesting, they list him at 6'2". He's probably more about 6 foot, but great confidence. 4-year starter here at Cal.
Second down and short for Dixon and the Ducks. Pulls out, deflected, incomplete, and there was that matchup. I'm telling you, 13 is on him like a glove. Here they are, 6'5 versus 5'11. But Hughes, the little engine who thinks he could, and he's doing a job tonight.
And the big play on third down when Oregon ran the option, Damian Hughes' run support was a key play, not only pass defense.
48 points on the board, 1:47 to go here in the third.
It's Berkeley crowds, impressive now.
They've been in it, haven't they, Bob?
They're in it.
There he got it back into the hands of Williams that time for another reception. And Kirk, what was the crowd like down in Gainesville? That could be pretty enthusiastic. Do they believe down there that Urban Meyer's got it going? What sort of a feeling did you get?
Well, they're undefeated since Urban Meyer's taken over down at the Swamp. And this is one of the loudest stadiums, as you guys know, in all of college football. They're so supportive. And I think they had a lot to do with why LSU turned the ball over so much.
You know, Kirk, as we think about the problems that Oregon is having here, and you go back to your playing days and Bob to his coaching days, what is it that teams have two personalities? They come on the road in a game like this, and they just don't play like they have up in Eugene. What do you think affects them the most?
I think maturity. I think we've seen on our broadcast with Ohio State the difference in having an experienced quarterback when you go on the road and a guy who really knows how to handle himself. And I think what's hurting Oregon is their only go-to guy right now is Jason Williams. They don't have anybody else to make plays on the other side.
Here's Kent. 45 first down. He's across midfield with a nice burst. Well, I told you this was old school, Bob. let's take you down inside the Ducks locker room. This is the visitors' locker room, folks. This is not like the one up in Eugene. And this is it now. Now, when they leave, they go downstairs, back upstairs, and then on out a tunnel. I mean, it is some entrance we want to show you here. First down and 10 for Dixon and the Ducks. Ball at the 45-yard line. Option, keeping it to the 41-yard line. So now here it is, Bob. Yeah. Look at the big fellas. He'll be real careful here now.
You talk about earthquakes. One of those big guys slips right there. But I promise you this, it'll be a lot longer walk back up that steps after this game, after the kind of whooping they're taking here tonight. But you try not to let things be distractions on the road. That is one of the worst visiting locker rooms I've seen.
And then you come out this tunnel, and at the end of the tunnel, another set of steps, and then you come up and you take your whooping. And they open a can of whoop, you know what, here. Second down. Drills it. Beautiful throw. And it's to the 29-yard line, and Jonathan Stewart, the running back, slips out. Now, they've held Stewart to 25 yards rushing on 18 carries. He came in, remember, averaging 7.9 yards a carry, but they can't shut him down. This is a fine throw by Dixon.
Both these tailbacks so similar, Marshawn Lynch and Jonathan Stewart. Not only power backs that can also break tackles, but excellent receivers as well.
And the final half minute now ticking away. End zone incomplete. Over through Williams. So it'll be second down and 10 coming up for the Ducks, who would dearly love to tack up 7 here late in the third. Get back to within 3 touchdowns if they can. Bellotti eyeing that clock, the time left.
So important when you're on the road to get off to a fast start. The faces of those Oregon fans shows it all. The first offensive snap of the game, you throw an interception. Tough to dig out of that hole all night long for the Ducks.
Second down and 10. Go deep now. Williams, touchdown. And there is a penalty flag. He may have pushed off. He may have pushed off Hughes. Let's hold on. Yep, that's what Hughes is signaling. I got pushed. And from the naked eye, that's what it looked like as they came across the goal. What'd you see, Bob?
I saw exactly what you saw. Dennis Dixon, great job of keeping the play alive, but.
Whoa. We didn't exactly see that, right? Damian, we were agreeing with you, but the vote that counts disagreed. Take a look, Coach.
We're going to get a great look at it right here. Keep in mind, Dennis Dixon scrambles. Now it turns into a scramble drill. Wow. Probably a good no call, period.
I agree. 29-yard touchdown pass. Yep. Williams, besides, it makes it closer. And get back to within 3 scores for our fourth quarter. So we've got, let's see, 50-some points up on the board. And, Kirk, it's Pac-10 football. It is amazing how when you come out here, how they throw it around. There's so much speed base. It's a different kind of game out here, isn't it?
Yeah, I think it's two things. I'd love to hear what Coach Davey has to say, but I think it's the quarterback and receivers in the Pac-10. They grow up in obviously in the West Coast. They have a chance to throw the football so much. They're so skilled by the time they get to college. And I also think on the other side, there's so much man-to-man coverage by the defenses, less zone blitz and more man-to-man. And I think the quarterbacks are good enough to pick those man-to-man coverages apart out in the Pac-10 every single week.
And the thing I see, Kirk, is just team speed on defense is not as impressive it is, for instance, in the Southeastern Conference. I look at right. USC as really the only Southeastern Conference style defense in this league, and that's why to me SC's struggling a little bit on offense, but they are still a dominant defense in my opinion. but it's overall team speeds lacking a little bit on the defensive side of the ball for some reason.
Guys, let's remember now, Jeff Sagarin said the Pac-10, surprisingly, this week, Kirk, he ranked them the number one conference in the country.
Wow.
And judging from what Arkansas did in Auburn, he might have something here now. From the six-yard line, O'Keefe. And he twists his way out to the 20. I know, Bob, that you kind of looked at me when I said that, but this is pretty impressive. Remember, USC, what do you think, Kirk?
I think that I don't care what Jeff Sagarin or any other computer out there says. With all due respect to our Pac-10 viewers, forget about it. The SEC is up here, and everybody else is down here. You know what they're down here? They're watching Cal take care of business tonight. They're laughing because of what happened in week one. And we all know Cal is a much better team than the way they played in week one. But unfortunately for the Pac-10, that's what the SEC and that's what the nation saw, how they played against Tennessee.
I tell you, Kirk, you just slapped Sagarin. But I agree with you. Just the environment and the defenses week to week in the Southeastern Conference can't compare.
Timeout. We've had a quarter in ESPN Saturday Night Football, presented by Southwest Airlines, returns after this message and a word from our ABC stations.
You're watching ESPN on ABC.
Bob Davey, Kirk Herbstreit, Lisa Salters, and Brent Musburger with you. We start the final 15 minutes, 38-17, fourth quarter. Campanile Tower there in the background. Lights on here tonight.
Brent, this is a beautiful place. But, you know, everyone always thought when it came to Cal football, there was a ceiling on this, that you could only take it so high because of high academic admission standards, maybe lack of interest. I think Jeff Tedford has shown that there is no ceiling on this program. He has done a remarkable job.
Amazing turnaround. And one of the only other ones that I could think of was Kansas State and Bill Snyder. That one was even tougher because they did not have as much talent in the vicinity as what they had here at Cal. But when you think about what those two schools were not accomplishing until Snyder and Tedford showed up, man, great stories. Let's check in with Matt Weiner. Get an update, Matt.
Mutual update from Athens, Georgia, in a Pac-10 style shootout in the SEC. Not exactly Georgia's kind of game. Mark Richt is 0-3 all time when his teams have given up 30 points. Tennessee now has 40. Eric Ainge to Jonathan Crompton there to set up the latest touchdown. The Vols lead it by 11 in the fourth quarter.
But the Dogs put 33 up on the board. And a lot of folks said they did not have an offense. Third and five, firing, incomplete. And fourth down. Now, let's go back on the story, and I'm going to bring Kirk in on this. In winning seasons, 2-34 years prior to Bill, with the Bears, 3-19 years, okay? Now, that's how they compared before Bill Snyder and Jeff Tedford took over. We'll get to what happened afterwards, but it was remarkable, the two turnarounds. Fourth down and five. Johnson. Down at the 30-yard line. We'll get back to the rest of the turnarounds at California and Kansas State with Kirk Herbstreit when we continue here on Saturday Night Football on ABC. It's a full moon over some of the most beautiful sights in the world.
The best is yet to come, and babe, won't it be fine? The best is yet to come. Come the day you're mine.
On the other side of the bay, the best maybe yet to come for these California Golden Bears. First and 10 for the Oregon Ducks, who trail at 38-17. Dixon looking to get downfield. Throws deep to Kent. And it's broken up. Hicks was right there, Coach.
Bernard Hicks starting because the starting safety Deku is out of the game, and you see the speed of Jordan Kent, but Bernard Hicks in great position right there on the deep ball.
really should have made that interception.
Second down and 10. Inside shuttle pass. And did he pick it off? They whistle it down and incomplete. And let's go back to that story we talked about, the turnaround. Let's bring in Kirk. What's your feeling about Kansas State and California? What Bill Snyder did and now Jeff Tedford here, Kirk?
Well, I think first of all, you have to recognize Bill Snyder had one of the better turnaround stories, I think, maybe ever in college football. You have to put Barry Alvarez up there, too. But what Jeff Tedford has done in this conference, in the Pac-10, being able to turn this program around now, and every single year, they are now considered a Pac-10 contender. I think that has to be recognized. But can he continue for the amount of time that Bill Snyder was able to keep Kansas State competitive is the next question.
Yeah, that's a very, very valid point. Third down and 10. And Dixon dropped by Kent. And he might have been across the scrimmage line. Do you think there is a penalty flag? Maybe there was some roughing back there, too. I don't know. The referee threw a late flag over there. Yeah, it was roughing the passer. And Jeff is not happy with that at that particular moment. Kirk, I think he's got a couple of things going. Bob, take a look at the first of this replay.
I think you're
going
to get Worrell Williams. Whoa. No question. Ooh. Just climbed and launched at the helmet of the quarterback, Dennis Dixon.
Been a little nasty out there, guys.
Yeah, we've had a couple of moments, Kirk. One that got overlooked on that kickoff that you probably saw. That was ugly, and he comes off to the sideline. Jeff was not happy with his own player, and it gives the Ducks a first down at the 45-yard line. Picked off. Intercepted by Hicks. And it'll be California Bear football at the 40-yard line. A team that has self-destructed here tonight in Berkeley.
And Bernard Hicks dropped the previous interception, but this one, Dennis Dixon just gift wrapped it and threw it right down the middle of the field to him. You take a look at it. Dennis Dixon, a young quarterback, is going to be a good player, but Brent, not in a position when you get far behind where he has to throw it every down. That's not his game.
When you put an option quarterback behind, Kirk, it is so tough to play catch up, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. Anytime you get down three touchdowns, I think it's tough for any quarterback. It could be Peyton Manning back there, let alone Dennis Dixon, who's still getting his feel and trying to make some plays. And as we talked about a little earlier, outside of Jason Williams, there just aren't enough playmakers out on the perimeter for this Oregon offense.
Dropped. The Bears drop one. It'll be second and 10. Marshawn Lynch has not returned here in the second half. He was injured in the first, and he put his helmet on over in the sideline. Lisa said he was clear to go back in, and probably it's a Tedford decision, Bob. Would you think with Cal enjoying a very comfortable lead not to go back with his number one running back and to keep Forsett in the game?
I think so. They have a comfortable lead, and there's not a great amount of drop-off with Justin Forsett, who he himself was a 1,000-yard rusher basically last year.
Now second down and 10 for Longshore and the Bears. And Forsett is thrown down at the 42-yard line.
And guys, we talked just a little earlier when I just came on with you, but just watching this game tonight, I'm watching DeSean Jackson all season, and I know you guys reviewed the tapes and watched him. I think because he's out in the Pac-10, I don't know if people really fully nationally appreciate his abilities. I'm just so impressed with his competitive spirit. One of these guys that always wants to ball. He's dangerous on special teams. People nationally need to start to pay attention to number one for the Cal Bears. The guy is the real deal.
Yeah, he's the most exciting player in the Pac-10. I don't think there's any question about that.
Yep.
Forsett banging to the 44-yard line and a first and 10.
And you know, you watch these two offenses, and I know this is kind of the age of spread offense, but there's something about Cal and the ability to run the ball downhill a little bit out of the more traditional pro set that I really like. I just like the balance of Cal's offense compared to Oregon's.
To go back, talked about brought that in there, brought that style in there, and it's amazing to see that you can run the spread without the athleticism from Nate Longshore. They can still have an effective attack.
Yeah, exactly. You mentioned the long range out here, and Kirk, with a massive remodeling job about to start, and there's so much football talent in this immediate area. I mean, goodness, De La Salle is close by. They've got a crowd of about 5,000 over at a high school game, and there's just a ton of talent in the Bay Area. So once this facility is upgraded, I think it's going to be, I think Tedford's going to be able to keep it going unless the lure of the NFL becomes too great. Now, I ask him about it. I do every time I see him. He's very comfortable living here. A couple of teenage children, his wife, and he remember now, he was once offered the head coaching job of the Chicago Bears. The reason why I think they're going to keep coming after Tedford, his attack works in the NFL, uses a fullback, uses three wides. Yeah, it's a little bit of spread with the shotgun, but it's not extreme. It's not an option attack. And he has proven he can deal with quarterbacks. Right now, let's check in with Matt Weiner and an update. Matt.
America Player of the Week update for you. Texas quarterback Aaron Ross was all over the fairgrounds this afternoon. A couple of picks, and he picked up a fumble and parlayed it into points in the Horns' Red River win. Text VOTE to 87654 on your singular wireless phone. You can vote for a chance at a trip to the national title game.
And Kirk, what'd you make of the Texas win in the Red River shootout over Oklahoma today?
I thought Colt McCoy, after the way he played against Ohio State, Brent, he was able to kind of get a second chance. People forget he's a freshman trying to replace Vince Young, and today it was his day and the Texas Longhorns' day.
Forsetta stopped short of the first down.
It's also Mac Brown's day, by the way.
Yeah, indeed. And then what about the demise of Florida State?
Boy, oh boy. We witnessed that firsthand Thursday night. And you know, I've been asked a lot about that the last couple of days. Is it more about Florida State dropping down? Is it the ACC coming back up? I think it's a little bit of both. You don't see the athletic ability that was on Florida State maybe 7 or 8 years ago. And definitely the ACC, not only with Virginia Tech and Boston College and Miami, but the other teams in the ACC, the athletic ability. Now Florida State gets challenged every single week in the ACC because of the collective speed. And that's different for this Florida State team to deal with. If they're not ready every single week to play their best game, there's a shot they can go down.
Yeah, the Bears have called a timeout. So we're going to take a break, and a reminder now, stay tuned for your late local news immediately following the game over most of these ABC stations.
Saturday Night Football on ABC, presented by Southwest Airlines. The low fare from here to there, it's on Southwest Airlines at southwest.com. Nissan, proud presenter of the 2006 Heisman. Visit theheismanvote.com to cast your vote. And Dish Network, better TV for all.
We are back, fourth down for Nate Longshore and the Golden Bears of California. You look at the Bay Bridge, which connects Oakland with San Francisco, 38-17, fourth down and one. Trying perhaps just to quickly draw them offside, then reset and go for it. And they stumble across for the first down with Justin Forsett. And again, a reminder, stay tuned for your late local news immediately following the game over most of these ABC stations. And then over on ESPN, SportsCenter will have post-game analysis along with all the scores and the highlights of the day. In case you mentioned it, the Tigers eliminated the New York Yankees.
You don't think anybody's sitting besides George Steinbrenner on that charter, huh?
Oh,
flying
off. I mean, what a season the Tigers have had. And of course, out here, that's a big story because the A's were awaiting the winner. A big cheer went up with this crowd when they were told it was going to be the Tigers and not the Yankees. And our Pacific Life game summary here tonight.
All about the turnovers in this football game, Brent. Oregon, to be quite honest, didn't show up and play. They're a much better football team than they have displayed here tonight. And then big play, home run ability of the Cal skill position players. You turn the football over and give this ball to the Cal offense that many times with the weapons they have, they're going to run you out of this stadium.
Inside of 8 minutes. Second down and six. They come with the end around with Robert Jordan. Short of the first down. Well, my spies tell me, Coach Davey, that Kirk Herbstreit has been nibbling pizza down there in Gainesville as we try to talk to him. So it's okay. He's clear now. And Kirk, we're gonna let you go. I know you want to spend a couple days back home, and then we'll meet up in Happy Valley. But in looking ahead now, what do you make of Michigan Penn State next week for us?
Boy, that I think that's Michigan's toughest game that they have left until they get to Columbus. And that's their last big obstacle at night in Happy Valley. Coach Davey saw it last year. It is magical. And that'll help the Lions to try to pull off an upset and knock off the Wolverines. It'll be great.
Absolutely. Looking forward to that, my friend. Game day will be down in Auburn first. And then Kirk will jet up to Happy Valley and join us. Justin Forsett moving the chains again as he has replaced Marshawn Lynch. And Kirk, thanks for joining us tonight. You and the gang did another fine job down there in Florida, and we look forward to seeing you next week.
Thank you very much. It's been great to be with you guys. I'm going to get back to the pizza here and go watch some more college football. See you guys.
All right, Kirk, see you next week.
You know what? If Kirk gets for Jessica Simpson, she'd come.
I was going to say he's got a shot, but I know he's a married man with about four sons at home, new baby. So I was going to let that go.
Well, we apologize.
I almost bid on that, but I.
we don't want to get anybody in trouble here, okay? I wouldn't think of that. First down and 10. Here's the toss play now. Boy, the young backup looks good. Breaks free. Touchdown, Cal. Puts it over 60.
I'll tell you what, Marshawn Lynch better get healthy, Brent, and get back in that lineup. This guy is taking advantage of his opportunities now.
He's had a 100-yard night replacing Marshawn Lynch. 23 yards on the touchdown. Here's Tom Schneider. Some are watching this extra point rather carefully. Right down Broadway. It's 45-17. It's a Cal Bear kind of night in Berkeley. Are they the team to beat in the Pac-10 and not USC? We'll find out later in the season.
Not the hard hat.
So the hard hat being presented. Marshawn Lynch to Justin Forsett. And Lisa, what's the story behind that?
Well, I went over and asked the guys, what's the hat all about? And they said that Marshawn gave it to him because it means it's time to go to work. And Coach Davey was saying that Marshawn might want to get back in this game because he might lose his job to Forsett. But it's actually Marshawn who decided not to go back into this game. He said that he came out at halftime, looked up at the scoreboard, and said, they don't need me. So it was actually his decision not to return.
All right, Lisa, thanks. And back on the goal line is Johnson. Jeremiah looking for a hole. To the 36, and a reminder now, Wednesday at 9, 8 Central, the all-new Lost. That's on right before the 9. For the survivors of Oceanic Flight 815, the real adventure is just beginning. Plan your escape, uncover the mystery, join the adventure. It's the hit series that's become a national phenomenon. And only on ABC. Lost Wednesday night, 9-8 Central Time.
Look at this crowd, Brent. Jeff Tedford's first year, Cal sold 16,000 season tickets. This year they sold over 40,000 season tickets. So that puts the exclamation point on this turnaround here with Cal football.
72,516 in Memorial Stadium here tonight. Sellout. Dixon going deep to Kent, and he's got it at the 20-yard line. So Jordan Kent coming up big. He's the speedster on the outside. Bob, when you take a look at the scores since the Tennessee whipping, Now let's first watch young Kent here.
Damian Hughes, the corner, gets a little distracted, loses focus right there, Brent, and let Jordan Kent to the outside.
A 113-yard night for Kent. 44 yards on that, and the Ducks, a penalty flag comes flying. They throw for a strike and a touchdown, but this one could be coming back. Hang on, it was the referee threw the penalty flag at the 30-yard line, so we'll see what he comes up with here. Now you can tell by the look on Bilotti's face. They have made one mistake after another here tonight. And the officials try to get this one sorted out, but
they called ineligible receiver downfield, but by looking at the formation, I don't know that that was the accurate call. I think the officials were just confused on this.
That's a touchdown. That's Oregon. The second time we've had a controversy.
And the reason they were confused, Oregon lined up with four wide receivers on one side and only one on the other, but it was a legal formation, and all the receivers were eligible.
So James Finley gets credit for the touchdown, making it 45-23. And then started to close in on 70. Evenson, incidentally, we were told, at the intermission has replaced Paul Martinez. Tightening up on the hamstring, the right hamstring a little bit. So that's why Evenson is kicking extra points as well as kicking off. Timeout. Well, you've been watching Saturday Night Football on ABC HD. Brought to you by the Dish Network. I mentioned earlier that after the Tennessee whipping, that this California team, they've been unstoppable. 42, 42, 49, 41, and 45 here. And one of the highest scoring teams in the nation. And this will be Luke Bilotti. He was the centerpiece of the controversy against Oklahoma. He kicked the onside kick, son of the coach, so he is on, and the Bears have the good hands people up. 10 people. He practices this every day for his dad. Gotta go 10, it did. Battle for the ball. California saying that they speared it. And Moy picked it off for the Golden Bears.
Maybe one of the most famous onside kicks in the history of college football, the Oregon-Oklahoma incident.
Speaking of famous kickoffs, you're looking down at the field where the most famous kickoff of all time took place. Every time I come in here.
And Rodney Gilmore here in the audience tonight, it's part of the crowd, was on the field for Stanford.
Yes.
In the Cal Stanford famous kickoff return.
When the Stanford band came on the field, I later we've got a penalty, and the trombone player later met him someplace. He came to a game that I was doing. The fellow who gets knocked down, and it's just. You know what? Let's take another look at it. Let's look and listen.
Harmon will probably try to swim it, and he does. Ball comes loose, and the Bears have to get out of bounds. Rodgers along the sideline. Another one. They're still in deep trouble at midfield. They tried to do a couple of... The ball is still loose as they get it to Rodgers. They give it back now to the 30. They're down to the 20. Oh, the band is out on the field. He's going to go into the end zone. He's going into the end zone. The Bears! The Bears have won!
I know that some Stanford folks turned away, but that is an all-time, man. First down and 5 here. And the Golden Bears, impressive. Very impressive here tonight. Let's
Let's take a look. We have focused in on the USC game November 18th. But before that's Washington State. Washington will have to come here. So will UCLA down to Arizona. What do you make of what they've got left?
I think dead aim at USC because their offense is so good and so explosive. I don't know if they're a great defensive team, Brent, but they are a great offensive football team. They can run the ball. They have depth at running back. They have three excellent wide receivers. And Nate Longshore just gets better and better each week.
Were you surprised here tonight? I know you were disappointed in Oregon's performance, but were you surprised in the positive side for Cal, Bob?
Surprised they played defense as well as they played defense. You know, Oregon came in here the number four offensive team in the country. I know they self-destructed a little bit, but I like the aggressiveness of Bob Gregory's game plan defensively for Cal.
Yeah, for the Ducks, they'll live to fight another day. They're tough up there in Eugene and disappointing night, but they're still 4-1. Again, a reminder now, just as soon as we wrap up the final 4 minutes, your late local news will be over most of these ABC stations and over on ESPN. SportsCenter will have post-game analysis along with scores and highlights. You're going to want to see the controversial pass interference call against Minnesota in the overtime game against Penn State. They'll run down the entire top 25. And the SEC was turned upside down because Auburn was beaten by Arkansas. Remember, USC, you know, that little discussion that we had earlier about rating the Pac-10 number one, you cannot look past USC's win in Arkansas. That was a big, big game. Nor can you look past the fact that Cal stumbled in Knoxville. But Cal has bounced back. USC still unbeaten, pushed to the wall by Washington today. I guess Arizona State would be a disappointing team to me out here in the Pac-10. Bob, would you agree with that?
I agree. Start out 3-0, lose to Cal by a big score, come back home, lose to Oregon by a big score. But they have an open date, maybe a chance to get back together before they go to USC.
Not quite sure that they ever recovered from that quarterback controversy that beset them just before the season started. Those things can be kind of jarring. And here on the pitch now to Justin Forsett, just short of a first down. He's a junior out of Arlington, Texas. So that tells you something about Tedford's reach in terms of recruiting and bringing players into Berkeley.
You know, we haven't talked much about Jeff Tedford and his staff. Obviously, Jeff Tedford coached at Oregon as the offensive coordinator, but he has, I think, four full-time coaches on his staff with Oregon background. And, Brent, I think about 15 support staff members from Oregon on his staff.
Let's take a look just exactly what you are talking about here. Let's take a look at the California Ducks, if you will. There's the head coach, defensive coordinator, wide receivers coach, linebacker. Look at the rest of the fellas, director of football operations, strength and conditioning, video coordinator, two football managers, recruiting assistant, and Ron Gould, who was a player at Oregon, now the running backs coach. I actually asked Jeff if this has created any tension, because that's a whole lot of folks to be bringing down out of Eugene, and he said no. He said that the wide receivers coach, Farino, his wife was living down here, so he was glad to come down. The rest of those fellows, they were elevated to
exactly. You know, Bob Gregory, for instance, comes here as the defensive coordinator. He was the linebacker coach at Oregon, went to Boise for 1 year. So, yeah, reading inside of that as we look at Bob Gregory, it was promotions. For even the guys that were the equipment men, assistant equipment guy at Oregon has a chance to be the head equipment guy at Cal. But don't underestimate what a big win this is just personally for Jeff Tedford to put this kind of whipping on Oregon.
Fourth down and one. Bears keep the ball, pick up a first and 10, and little Justin Forsett has been a tough hombre and some after the whistle wrestling.
And I'll tell you what, the little running backs in this country, let's think about the little guy Garrett Wolf at Northern Illinois, same style. The little running back at Rutgers, Ray Rice, I believe, is his name.
The Bear coach is on the field, not happy with the extracurricular.
Dead ball, unsportsmanlike conduct. Offense number one, 15-yard penalty from the end of the run, first down.
your guy still chirping right there, DeSean Jackson. You wonder why he's in the game this late, but the offensive leaders from Cal, certainly Nate Longshore, on fire since the Tennessee game. I don't know if he played his best game tonight, but he played well enough. Forsett is a weapon as the backup tailback. Could probably start for most schools in the country. And then DeSean Jackson, I think the most dynamic player in the Pac-10. But, Brent, why is he still in there? It's 45-24. Get him out.
He had that 64-yard punt return for the touchdown. Some of those youngsters, you know, they slip back on the field. They substitute themselves back in.
I'm not sure I wouldn't take that tailback out right now, too.
Final 3 minutes. Another penalty flag flying in the secondary. And, you know, it's time just to clean it up, say nice things to each other, and go on about your business. These youngsters, a lot of them know each other. They have been recruited from schools around Northern California because Oregon comes in here.
Dead ball, personal foul, late hit, number 7 of the offense. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run, second down.
And LaVell Hawkins picks up a late hit.
Brent, you bring up a good point. So much familiarity between these players. Oregon with 41 players from California. You know, they recruit similar guys. Obviously, Jeff Tedford doesn't like that.
Well, he made his feelings very well known over there on the.
And Mike, he's just numb right now after all that's happened tonight.
Yeah, they had faced each other 3 times before and decided by a total of 12 points. This will even them up. Velotti will have won twice in Eugene, and now Jeff Tedford twice down here. Here he goes. He explodes to the 13-yard line. Justin Forsett, who was recruited out of Texas, gives him a first and 10, having a career night. 48 more yards.
And you talk about running straight downhill north and south untouched. We have to give credit to this Cal offensive line. But I'm going to tell you what, Marshawn Lynch, get healthy over there on the sidelines. This guy right here, he may not give that job back.
As you might expect, coming out of Arlington, Texas, his nickname here, Texas. And they raise him tough in Texas. And for Forsett, 164 yards, 1 touchdown. O'Keefe, who's not bad himself, the third running back, now on the field. So we talked about recruiting here tonight. And let's check out where Oregon goes. You can see California, they come in for 41 of their players, 21 out of Oregon, and over to Hawaii for 4. 90 players from 17 different states. And then look at the Bears. 98 from California. They get 3 out of Hawaii. They go up to Oregon for a pair and up to Washington.
A lot of players from Hawaii in this game. A lot of Polynesian players. Both schools having success going to Hawaii. And then America Samoa to get players.
140. This is coming to an end. And California is going to tack up another W. 5 game winning streak. And here's our Chevrolet players of the game. Jordan Kent for Oregon, 6 catches, 113 yards, and the quarterback for the Cal Bears, Nate Longshore, throwing for 3 touchdowns tonight and 189 yards. Remember, he threw an interception in the end zone. He just kept right on firing, used his weapons. And there's Jordan Kent, son of the basketball coach. In recognition of their efforts, Chevrolet will make a $1,000 contribution to each university's general scholarship fund. Big win for California. 69 points on the scoreboard, 45-24. We'll see what Jeff elects to do here on 3rd and 6. Now O'Keefe, 35 seconds. Bellotti and the Ducks needing to regroup. Longshore and the Bears win a big one. They step it up big time and run to the logo, and now some of the players drifting over to shake hands with each other. And a victory celebration underway in Berkeley. Let's go down now to Lisa.
Just right here.
Nate, you came over to the sidelines to me twice during the game to say I told you so. Tell the folks at home what you meant.
I did not do that. That's a myth. She's making that up. I didn't say it. All I said was our defense was going to show up to play. That's what I said.
Even the guys up in the booth late in the game said they were surprised by how your defense played tonight against that high-powered Oregon offense. So why were you not surprised?
Going against them every day, we know how good they are. And when they come out to play, I mean, they're the best around. So, you know, my hat's off to the defense. They did an outstanding job.
Now, with Marshawn Lynch on the sidelines with that hurt leg, how easy did Justin Forsett make your job tonight?
He's the man. I mean, we got two running backs outstanding, three running backs outstanding. More so than that, we got an offensive line that dominated tonight. I think they showed that. I was very impressed. We moved the line of scrimmage all night long, and that's that's all you got to do to be successful.
Now, lastly, it's not official, but I don't think that Jessica Simpson made it tonight. Are you going to be okay?
That's all right. Well, there's more games. There's more games.
All right. Congratulations, Brent.
All right, Lisa. He's a piece of work, folks. Nate Longshore. Let him do a 45-24 victory. The Golden Bears win a big one. And a reminder now, join us next week, Saturday Night Football on ABC. Most of you will see Michigan take on Penn State. And some of you out west will watch Arizona State take on USC. 8 p.m. Eastern time, the big one, Michigan at Penn State. Thanks for watching ESPN on ABC. For Kirk Herbstreit, Bob Davey, and Lisa Salters, I'm Brent Musburger saying so long from Berkeley, everybody.
Special presentation of ESPN on ABC.